All right, guys, what's going on? We're here, we're live. Welcome to a brand new Poker Life podcast. My name's Joey, your 1AK Chicago Joey. We ran a little late today because Olivier was locked out of his place he's staying at. And
Samantha's place.
What'd you say, Olivier? You're at Samantha's place?
Yeah, Samantha. And by the way, when I was locked out, she was sitting here on the couch the whole time.
Oh my God, it's gonna be a fun podcast, guys. So Olivier's locked out, but now we're starting. We're live. And we're going to be discussing today the Super High Roller Bowl, the $300,000 tournament that just got wrapped up. It was a four-day event at the Aria Casino Hotel Spa Resort. I don't know. I've heard it enough times over the past couple days. And so we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be talking about how the event was, in my opinion, was a very successful event. It was very entertaining. I haven't really watched televised poker like that I don't remember, maybe high stakes poker or some of the poker after dark, maybe cash game events.
Yeah,
so we're going to talk about that, talk about the good, the bad, the ugly, if anything ugly. And we're just going to talk about maybe some lasagna strategy. I don't know what we're going to talk about today. We got Olivier back on the pod. What's up, Olivier?
What's up?
Welcome back to the live stream, buddy.
What's up, Poppy?
Poppy, what are you doing over there, man? You've been having an eventful past couple of weeks since the last podcast.
I was doing a little bit of traveling, was in Jamaica for a bit, played scoops, went home. I just got to Vegas last night, so I'm in Vegas, played ball for the first time. I'm psyched for the summer, man. It's going to be a great summer. I'm psyched for you to get here, too.
I am psyched to get there. I'm also psyched, but I'm psyched to do a couple of things. You know, I'm in California, so shout out to California, and I'm having some – we got to save this. We got to save why I'm having fun to the end of the fucking podcast. Shout out to the staff. I know they're out there watching right now, but – So you watched the Super High Roller Bowl, right?
Yeah, I watched the first couple of days. I didn't see yesterday because I was flying. But I watched the beginning of it. Yeah, I thought it was dope. I mean, Nick and Ali were so good. Like, they're a great team. I think Nick's one of those guys that, like, at least from my point of view, I always thought he seemed like a really chill guy, like a cool guy. Obviously, he's a boss in poker. But he's one of those guys that's kind of like enigmatic, you know? You don't really know what he's like. He's not super talkative at the table. Unless you like really get to know him, you're not kind of sure what his deal is. And right. I felt like he was really natural commentating, like not just talking about strategy, but just flowing with Ali. I mean, they're talking for so many hours that you like start to get to know him a little bit. And he was just like really chill, just like really genuine. I thought he was great. And Ali, obviously, like I worked with him at Alpha 8 and he's just super funny and for a color guy, like knows so much more about poker than almost any other guy. And he can just like carry time, you know, on air. So I thought they made it like much better than it could have been otherwise.
Yeah. I thought, so we're talking about, for those who didn't see the tournament, it was, I was supposed to announce it at the beginning. My sponsors are going to be upset now, but the first 20 minutes, if you're watching this on YouTube, guys, the first 20 minutes will be available on YouTube. After that, we're going to be switching over to a German network. It's called Kabel Ins. And you'll be able to find that on your German television provider, assuming that you live in Germany. And just because production costs today, I mean, we had to get Olivier back on the podcast. You know, he's an expensive fucking guy these days, and after he's taking down fights and stuff like that. So to cover production costs, and in honor of the Super High Roller Bowl, kind of going with their format they chose to go with in terms of airing their product, we're going to go ahead with that, guys. So, yeah, first 20 minutes on here. After that, you had to switch over that. And please, nobody Periscope it. Please, nobody stream it on Twitch. Just please, thank you.
What if you don't live in Germany, then how do you watch it?
You know what, Olivier, that's a great question. So let's assume you didn't live in the United States and you were trying to watch a Super High Roller Bowl, one of the most anticipated television poker tournaments of the year. How were you supposed to watch it, Olivier? That was the $1 million question. How did you watch it this year, my friend, if you didn't have CBS Sports Network?
I mean, I did have it, but I guess you didn't. Weren't people Periscoping it, which you just told people not to do?
Yeah, well, they seemed upset. So I guess, you know, from following some tweets on the Poker Central guys, shout out to Sam, shout out to a couple other guys that were tweeting out at Poker Central. They seemed kind of, they seemed like they were upset because CBS Sports Network, guys, if you don't live in the USA, first of all, you don't have access to it.
Right.
If you live in the USA, not many people actually have access to it as well. So it was just really hard to find on television. And most people ended up taking to the Periscope Street. Shout out to Higgins. Shout out to Sporter69. You guys were legends. We appreciate you guys. You guys died for our enjoyment. I appreciate your accounts being sacrificed for a temporary period of time.
That was a quality Timex tweet.
What did you say?
That was a quality Timex tweet with Squirter69.
I know. It's, I know. A guy named fucking Squirter 69 was the guy that allowed all of us to watch day two and day three of the Super High Roller. So, you know, I guess that from your standpoint, you know, what do you think about that, the strategy they went with in terms of to get the Super High Roller out there for and sort of limiting the access of the easeability to watch it for a lot of people out there?
By the way, Sam has a question about the link. Did you tweet the link?
Yeah, I tweeted the link. Okay. But I tweeted the link.
She's rolling her eyes. She's saying that you didn't.
I tweeted the link 2 hours ago, Samantha.
Oh, there's another.
She's so funny when she's like not happy. She's like, what do I think? I mean, I don't know.
Wait a second. We're going to cut to commercial right now while you're in the middle of that answer. Hold on. Guys, we're going to be back in a couple minutes after we get a sponsor. Our sponsors are going to run a commercial. They're going to be airing for the next 35 minutes straight, the same commercials on repeat for four commercials. So, guys, check. All right, Olivia, go ahead. Sorry, we're done. I had to honor the Super High Roller Bowl properly. Hold on. Okay, you're go ahead.
I'm so lost right now, by the way. I'm just letting you lead, and I'm just following. I don't know what's going on.
Wait, you don't know what I'm referencing here.
What?
You don't know what I'm referencing right now.
No. You're referencing what you're...
You can tell I watched. Okay, so during the Super High Roller Bowl, if you like watch, like we were like me and McLean were over here on the we're like railing hard. We were just like super into it. And
I was watching it.
They went to commercial every, like during the heads up, it was like two hands commercial, Dollar Shave Club commercial.
Oh, I didn't see the heads up. I didn't see the last day, so I don't know. But during the other 2 days, I feel like they went to commercial a lot during the breaks, but not really that much before break, like during actual play.
Hmm. Yeah, kind of. They kind of went to commercial. I feel like a lot of the what I was reading on Twitter was a lot of discussion about, and now a commercial break, and now a commercial break. So,
yeah, I don't know. I mean, they got to pay their bills. Like, I don't know. I don't know if it was a deliberate strategy on their part to limit access. They just made a deal with CBS Sports. So, like, wherever CBS Sports is carried, that's the deal they made. So that's the network. I mean,
you know. I guess the, you know, because they did. So they made it where it was. Did you have any pieces in the High Roller Bowl at all?
No, I don't buy pieces.
Why not?
Because I don't want to owe people money, and I don't want to be owed money for sure. I stay away from being owed money.
Yeah, it's. I gotta say, compared to some people we have on the podcast, that's a unique strategy because most people seem to.
Oh, I'm totally. Yeah, I mean, every other person that I know, like, buys pieces, like, gambles hard. Like, I just don't. That's just not my thing. I just don't do that shit at all. I've never done it. Like, I don't even swap, really. I hardly ever swap. Pretty much never.
Hmm. Do you think if you played more of the high buy-in tournaments, you'd swap more just to sort of reduce variance in those events?
Not really. I mean, sometimes it's part of the reason that I don't want to play just because fields are tough or I just, like, I'm not as confident in my game. Like, if I wanted to swap more, I would probably have play more. So I think it goes the other direction. But, I mean, I've probably played, I don't know, how many Super High Rollers have I played? I don't know, maybe, like, 8 or 10. So, I mean, not that many, but I mean, this one was amazing. I really should have played this one. Like, this one was probably the best tournament ever. Like, no rake, 49. Like, how many of the 49 did they guarantee were not professionals? Like, 7 or 8? I mean,
So I think it was, I think one backed out at the last minute in PLP, Pussy 11 for 2, she ended up getting a seat. And they also added $300,000 to the prize pool.
Right, yeah, exactly. Sick value for that tournament. If they do right. Definitely going to try to play like right away.
So I'm curious to see what's going to happen next year with that event, because this year, as you mentioned, there were, you know, I think there were 9 or 10 recreational players that played this year. I mean, obviously some of these guys, you know, they play more events than others, so they may not be full blown recreational players.
Talal's really good.
Who?
Talal Shakirchi, the guy who won the Scoop Main and cashed like 30 times in Scoop or something.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean,
he's good.
Do we consider him a recreational player now? I guess.
I'm sure in the list of 10, I'm sure he counts as one of them.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I guess he probably would count as one. I mean, I would assume that the highest level of players in tournaments think that he would be, I guess, a step below. I mean, I'm sure even if he's really good, I would imagine that most of the guys would just consider him a step or two or more below than, I guess, the top level players.
I'm assuming, though, that a lot of people would put his edge in the tournament, like, above at least some of the professionals.
I'm not trying
to call out names, man. I don't know. I'm just saying. I don't think the order is all of the professionals and then Talal. I think Talal is like somewhat above some of the pros.
Well, I feel like he probably plays a lot more too as well. Like, as you mentioned, he played a ton of scoop. He won the scoop main event, which is absurdly sick. And he cashed a ton in the scoop. And I think he was grinding the low buy-in scoop events. Like, he's definitely playing.
Yeah, I mean, he contributes to forums. Clearly, he's studying the game. He's been playing for years. I mean, he's obviously a very smart, driven guy. There's no reason why he wouldn't get good, you know?
Yeah. That's a good point. I guess, yeah, that's a really good point. I don't want to rank any players, whatever. So yeah.
I'm not Doug. I'm not here to...
You sure?
I'm pretty sure.
I almost whipped out the Doug impression right now. I did some ranking. Oh, come on. God, all right. Guys, okay, let me get out the Bazam's cooking jar, man. Hey, rank some players, man. Yeah, he's just a bad player, man. Livy's just a bad player. All right, I can't do no more, Doug. That's all.
Yo, I really like that you just put your all into the impression, though. Like, I feel like you'd be great for people to just call out names and just randomly do impressions.
Yeah, but I'm terrible at impressions, though.
Yeah, but you try. That's the point. Like, if you told me to do an impression, I would just, like, be like, nah, I'm not going to do that.
Well, some people in the chat said, yo, who's that girl in the background? Well, Alex, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. So for those that don't
know, that girl in the background, yo.
Okay, so for those that have been following since the last podcast, we've had a podcast guest, Unination. Is that a word? It's not a word.
Unination? Look, Jesus.
I can't think of the goddamn word. I need my dictionary. But we've had a podcast.
A coupling?
We've had a podcast coupling of two of our favorite podcast guests, Olivier Busquet and Samantha Abernathy. So, and if you haven't been following on Snapchat, if you haven't been following on Twitter, they've been posting some pictures. They've been in some exotic locations. So yes, that is Samantha Abernathy in the background right there.
Yes,
so it's like
a
unification. That's the word I'm looking for.
Unification. We unified the belts.
So yes, there's a romance on our hands, guys, and that is currently what you're witnessing.
I mean, yeah.
Taking
yes.
Place,
no. Sam and I.
To answer the question. But yeah, okay, let's do a Sam impression. I have a Sam impression. Do you have a Sam impression, Olivier?
No, I'm not. I would never go there. I mean, I do actually have, I have like a bunch of them, but they're really just for her. I don't break them out for the public use.
Okay, I kind of got a Sam. Nah, I don't got a Sam impression. Never mind. I don't have one. All right. So, I thought another big reason why the Super High Roller was really well, and I'm surprised we haven't seen other. Maybe we have. We just don't know about it. Is that the combination of the seven handed, which was played six handed as well too,
right?
And the shot clock. I mean, it seems like that made for just much more action. Even watching it live, it just made it so much more entertaining than past live stream live events.
All right, so I first of all completely agree. Second of all, I don't know what you thought, but I genuinely think that like Dan Smith made a mistake because of the shot clock. In my opinion, like the set over set hand, like his hand is a clear check call in that spot with those stacks. But it seemed to me that once he put the time bank in on the flop, he was almost like more committed to like making a non just call play. Like he was like, it was almost like, okay, now he has to raise. Cause he asked for more time and it's just the flop. Like if he just calls, it's going to look weird. Maybe that's in my mind. Maybe I don't think he would even like acknowledge that. I don't know. But right when he put the time thing in, I said out loud, I was like, he's going to raise now. And he's going to lose his stack because I was just like, wow, the time thing actually made a difference. I think if he was just had infinite time, he would have thought for a long time and then called.
So for those who didn't see, Olivier is referencing the hand. I believe it was at the final table, maybe nine.
It was on the bubble.
Yeah, it was on the bubble. So was it really the that was the bubble hand?
No, I mean, he didn't bust that hand, but he got down to like 150K. He got down to like three or four big blinds.
Right. It was a hand versus Dan Smith versus that ended up winning. Reiner Kempe, I believe is his name.
It's
and
Flop. Reiner, right? Sam, what is it?
Yeah, it's Reiner.
Reiner Kempe. Shout out to Reiner. I believe he's grinding the Colossus today. Shout out to Reiner for getting that.
I was actually going to ask if he was going to play the Colossus. That's a real... Yeah. Boss move to play the Colossus the next day.
Yeah, he's in the field right now. But there was a hand. The flop was 10-6-8. Reiner raised pre-pop, I believe. Dan defended. No. What'd you say?
With two hearts.
Yeah, 10-6-8, two hearts. Reiner had a set of eights. Dan Smith had a set of sixes. And what Olivier's referencing is that instead of check calling continuation bet, he decided to check raise. And so they're on a bubble. It's obviously a pretty huge pay.
And there were at least two or three players that had less chips than both of them.
can't remember exact stack size. Who, yeah, I'm trying to remember who else was on the bubble there.
It was like 2.3 and 2.1, and like somebody, at least a couple people had like I think Phil had less than 2 million. I think Eric had less than 2 million. I think at least two or three people had less than 2 million. So, I mean, I just think it's, in my opinion, it's just a, you know, especially because this kid is good. Like, he's not just randomly c-betting that flop. I mean, so I think you're just not going to get it. You're not, it's not like you're going to get in with aces there. So, I mean, when you check raise, I just think you're in a bad spot. And he knew it. I mean, he knew it. But I just thought the time thing, it was just one specific example where I thought the time thing made a difference. But I'm sure there are other instances, especially with guys who play slowly. Guys like D. Peters or Byron or whatever. Like, those guys who in their natural flow now have to do something. They have to include the fact that they have to put in a time bank. They have to include the fact that they have a limited number of time banks. So if it's not that big of a hand, like, is it worth it to, like, you know, do your normal thing, or do you just have to kind of change your flow, you know, because whatever, because of the spot. So I think it definitely does change it for some people. For me, like, for example, I probably would use a time bank like twice, three times the entire tournament. I play super fast.
Right. I mean, you're used to playing multiple heads up matches at one time too. So I guess for you, you're like, okay, I don't need that much fucking time.
Oh shit. We're at a, can we plug this in, Sam?
Yeah.
Thank you.
But yeah, I think for overall viewer experience, it seems really well. And I think a bunch of people on Twitter have been mentioning this, that even playing in it, instead of people doing this, doing a lot of tanking.
Well, sorry, hold on 1 second. Go ahead.
So instead of people doing a lot of tanking, now you actually have people playing fast. And it seems like for the players do enjoy playing with that format as well too.
Yeah, I mean, Daniel was saying it was, you know, everyone that he spoke to liked it, and I think it's definitely better for TV. So yeah, I mean, I think it's good. I haven't played any tournaments like it, but it's starting to catch on, I guess.
Yeah, I would imagine that it seems like it's going to become more of a thing. I feel like you had the loudest people like Negreanu and other people sort of advocating for it, and I feel like we're going to see that become more of a thing, especially when we watch some of these other live streams. Like, I mean, it's really fucking boring, so... Yeah, I think that might be a cool way to enhance the viewer experience for people.
And I also think, like, structurally, it's difficult to mount an argument against it. Because the only people that are really against it are the people who take a little bit of extra time. And so they're making such nakedly self-interested arguments that it's hard for people to be convinced by them. People are just like, yeah, you want to take more time, so... You know what I mean? There's no like, overall group of people that, like, you know, it's, if people assume it or just think it's better for the viewing audience, so it's like, that's... huge weight on that side.
Yeah. Well, even as playing, I mean, I understand that you're going to be playing a lot of tournaments over the next month at the World Series of Poker, since you're going to be grinding a full schedule, I believe. So maybe we'll revisit this thought in 1 month when you're like, God, this tanking. They need a shot clock would be really fucking nice in these situations.
I mean, I'm already like in favor of a shot clock. I mean, I just, but again, for me personally, like, I play fast, so.
Yeah. Why would Matt Campbell and I didn't actually ask, why was Olivier and others so butthurt about Helmuth table talk? Is that true?
I wasn't butthurt about it. I just think he's just like obnoxious and disrespectful. That's all. I mean, I'm not, like, it doesn't like upset me. It doesn't keep me up at night. But like at the end of the day, like, people have to understand Phil Helmuth is like one of the most well-known poker players in the world. And he represents the poker community as much as anyone else does in poker. So when he acts like a dick, like, making fun of people, like yelling and cursing, insulting, whining, like when he acts like that, it's a reflection on all of us. You know what I mean? When he does it in such a public way. So, I mean, you know, some people made the argument that it's better for TV. I don't even deny that. I agree it's more entertaining. But like being undignified is more entertaining for television. That's just like a basic rule that, like, you can, you know, why do you think reality TV shows are so popular? I mean, it's like, that's not, and for me, that's not enough of an argument to justify it. Like, there's plenty of things we could do at poker tournaments to make it more entertaining, but we don't because, you know, some of them are just like not cool things to do. So, yeah. You know, in my opinion, he does it because emotionally it allows him to vent, whereby if he were to like keep it inside, I think his play would suffer a lot more. And he knows that about himself. You know, his wife's a psychiatrist, right? I mean, this guy is not like, it's not like this guy's just, he's been doing this for a long, long time. I mean, I think he understands that this is the way that he can try to, this, he's doing this for himself. He's not, do, I mean, he argues sometimes that he does it to be more entertaining, but I don't think that's true. I don't think he's really fully in control of it. And also, if people have played with him out when there's no camera, he does the same thing. He's not just doing it for the camera. I mean, he went off on me like 5 or 6 years ago at the WPT Championship, 3 tables left. There were no cameras there. Like, he didn't like the way I played a hand, and it was a pretty standard hand, actually, but he didn't like the way I played it, and he lost the pot, obviously. He, like, gets up. He goes ballistic. He goes over to the other 2 tables, and he's like, do any of you guys know who this idiot is? You know, he's, like, talking mad shit. And this was, like, early in my tournament career. And I was thinking to myself, like, imagine if I wasn't, like, relatively confident in my poker game and, like, relatively confident in social situations. Like, this guy would, like, this would feel, it already didn't feel particularly good, but this would feel really shitty. Like, really shitty if this guy did this and I was just, like, a little bit awkward or insecure and, like, I would be like, I was just like, wow, this is not cool at all. And, like, again, there were no cameras. The only people that were around were other players at the tournament, like the tournament director. And he was just like, you know, just really not cool, you know? So, like, whatever. It is what it's not doing this for he's not doing this for the camera.
That's interesting. I'd like to wonder, you know, I guess we don't know too many, like, what do the recreational players think about his play from playing poker with him? Do they enjoy that? Do they, as you said, it definitely probably doesn't feel very good. Maybe it brings out the competitiveness in some people, but at the same time, maybe he's at a point where he's so popular that.
I think it depends. I mean, I think it depends on different people. Some people probably think it's funny and some people probably get genuinely offended by it. But I think overall, especially like when he gets genuine, because sometimes, you know, there are different levels to his engagement and his negativity and stuff. I think when he gets like genuinely upset, I think it creates real tension at the table and it's unpleasant. And he tries to really dominate. He like sucks the air out of the table. He like really dominates the interactions. Like, I mean, I think it really creates an unpleasant atmosphere to play in, you know, maybe not universally, maybe not every time, but like on net. Yeah. I don't think it's fun to be in that situation. And I don't think it's fun to have him directly insulting you as you play. I don't think that's fun at all. You know?
I don't think you think he's going to, I mean, I guess he's not going to change at this point in time. It seems like he's pretty, this is kind of poker's person. Like, right. I didn't seem like he's going away from poker. It seems like he's probably going to stick around poker. And, you know, I think, you know, it's funny. So there's this kind of narrative now before the tournament happened, people were saying, oh, Phil Hellmuth, you know, come on, he's not that good, yada, 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 whatever. Now he goes deep in this tournament, makes some very, very, very out of the box plays in terms of balance. He's redefining the word balance in tournament poker, but he goes deep and people are so fucking results oriented. They're like, no, maybe he's just got his own style. He knows how to play. And this might even be true. It could be true. I could definitely hear the argument on this. Maybe he just knows how to play his style so well that he's just that fucking good because he went deep in 149 man field. I think it's interesting how this narrative now from some people is that no, maybe not. He's got his own style. Maybe he's ahead of the times.
I mean, I think the argument's actually a little stronger than that. I mean, he did like cash in the first million one drop. He did go deep in last year's 100K one drop. I mean, he does have now a number of like super big buy-in caches. I don't know how many of those tournaments he's played, but he's definitely like up in those tournaments. Obviously, super small sample, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But like, I'm sure there is something to not just his style, but he's the kind of guy that's, it's tough to take him seriously, right? Cause he calls it like white magic and he talks about himself, but like, I'm sure he's actually decent or pretty good at reading people. I'm sure that's a true thing. Why wouldn't it be? So like, right. Yeah, I'm sure his fundamentals suffer. If he were to play online, he would have no chance. Like overall, I think he makes a lot of mistakes, but like, I'm sure he has pretty good reading ability and can make up for it in certain spots and in small fields. Maybe he knows how to navigate and is, you know, is better than people give him credit for. I wouldn't be surprised if that's true.
Maybe he's one of the best. He could be.
I mean, that's the thing. I don't think there's any chance that he's like in the top, you know, 10 or 20 of the field, but he doesn't, I mean, you don't need to be impressive. Like, I don't think I'm in the top fucking 10 of that field. You know what I mean? Like, it's a fucking tough top 10 of that field. It's really good. I mean, what the fuck? It's really good.
Someone said, why did Hollywood Hex call out Seidel on Twitter? Okay. You guys need to like work on your sarcasm detectors, guys, because he's obviously fucking joking. He's talking. Come on. I'm not even, come on. He's kidding. Okay. That's it. Let's move on. Next one. Okay. That's all we got right there.
He doesn't even make that joke. His original tweet, like, it just says, whatever, the eight of the best players, there's six of the best players in the world plus one baby. And then it was like someone else who was like, or Jason, I think, said, I never thought you'd call out Eric Seidel like that. And then Isaac responded to that. But his original tweet wasn't even, didn't mention Eric.
Right.
I think. Yeah. That was clearly a joke, guys. He was talking about Phil Hellmuth, not Eric Seidel.
Yeah, I think I wrote a bunch of other things down here to why I thought the term was really good. I mean, it was really like a perfect storm because you have debatably some of the best players in the world. You have some fun players. You could debate it. We could debate it, couldn't we?
You're saying there, it's possible that none of the best players in the world were playing?
No. It's debatable on the amount of the best players in the world were playing in it.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Debatable. Everything's debatable, I've learned.
Everything is. You're going to say debatably before anything you say.
Right, exactly. Debatably some of the best players in the world. Okay. The presentation of it, the set, it's a beautiful set.
Production quality is good.
Yeah, the audio quality in terms of the announcing I thought was great.
Yeah.
Now some people might argue differently, and you said you did enjoy it as well too. The shot clock, the seven-handed, the biggest names. It was just like a perfect storm of events, and it was great. I got to say, I wish something like this happened more, but I'm not sure if this was more of a thing, would that sort of take away from how great we perceive this to be?
I think so. I think maybe twice a year is like the max, maybe three or something, but you can't have this once a month. You just can't. I don't think you can do that. First of all, I won't go broke, but I mean, yeah, you can't do that.
Someone says, do you need me to bring me some aloe vera? Yes, I do. I was just playing at basketball outside with no shirt on, and I'm definitely a little burnt back here, guys. So if you have any aloe vera and you're in Irvine, Breeze, bring it over to the house.
You're playing ball outside?
Yeah, there's basketball outside. You combine two things. You work on your tan and work on your basketball game.
I that's cool. I haven't played basketball outside in a long time.
Yeah, well, you got me. I guess you can't really in Vegas because it's so freaking hot there. And
yeah, I mean, I don't know. I just don't – I never really consider it. I mean, I'm always just looking for a gym, even when it's nice out.
Yeah, I never really tried it before either until I was like, well, instead of going to the pool and sit there and get a tan or go to the beach and get a tan, which the beach is fun too, I could just go outside and play basketball, which I already want to play anyway. So it kind of like combines two things into one. So
nice.
So the commentating, we talked about the commentating briefly before. I thought Ali Nashad, I thought he's very funny. And he definitely said some things that I was like, how could he say those things and he not get in trouble to say those things?
Right. Yeah.
Some of the jokes were pretty, pretty something. But yeah, I thought they did a good job. And in terms of Nick Schulman, yeah, I don't know. It seems like an odd selection to have someone that really doesn't focus on Nolman Hold'em or focus on tournaments to be the commentator for a Nolman Hold'em tournament big buy-in event. But I thought he did a pretty good job. But I'm kind of a hard judge. I'm not really sure, you know, what makes a good Nolman Hold'em tournament.
Like, I mean, Nick's really good at Nolman Hold'em tournaments. Like he's really good. Like he doesn't focus on them, but he doesn't need to focus on them to be good. I mean, I've played with him. He has very good results. Whenever he plays, like everyone respects him at the table. I mean, he's got really good live presence. I think he understands like fundamentally like the game like well enough. I mean, well enough to like do commentary. Right. And I thought his commentary itself was like, you know, the best word that I have to describe his commentary was like accessible. You know what I mean? Some people, they can talk about poker theory, but they can only really talk about it in a way that's very technical and that's just like kind of boring and just difficult to understand. He could relate some sophisticated concepts in ways that people could understand without knowing a ton about poker. I thought he was very good and just very natural because, you know, I've had the experience of doing both a live stream for like 6, 7, 8 hours in a row and the experience of doing an edited TV show. And like, it gets tiring. I mean, these guys did commentary for what, 10, 12 hours a day, like 3 or 4 days straight. I mean, I'm not surprised, to be honest, that some of Ali's jokes and some of their, sometimes they kind of went off the rails, but you know, like get into some dicey territory. I mean, you know, you start to relax and you start to just talk normally because you're there for so long. You know, if you're just doing, you know, you're doing takes and you're just an edited show or whatever, I mean, that's totally different. When you're just there for 10 hours straight, it's like, man, you're going to drop some like regular conversation in there.
That's actually a good point you bring up about he did a good job of making what he was saying relatable. I feel like a lot of people could understand it because as you mentioned, certain players or certain people when they talk strategy, they do get Like, okay, for example, if you listen to the World Series of Poker Final Table live streams during the summer with Tuck, when Tuck has certain guests on, that's exactly how they are. They do a very not very good job in terms of relating their strategy and what they're trying to say and just make it like easy or like enjoyable to understand. And I thought Nick definitely did a really good job at that in terms of
they only have one way to talk about poker, and it's the way they talk with their friends. And it's just like it's in a way like a different language, and you need to know the language to understand. Nick talked about the same kinds of things in a language that just a wider audience can understand.
How does Nick get that job and you don't get that job, Olivier? What's up with that, man?
I don't know. They didn't approach me. I thought Nick did a great job. I mean, I think they made the right choice. I mean, he was good.
I love it, man. I already know what you're going to say before I ask you the question. It's great. I don't even need to ask. I got to ask it out of, you know, I got it format. I got it written down over here, didn't I?
That was one of the questions. Why didn't you get the job?
You're right. I would have done a great job on that. That's what I thought you were going to say. But then you said that answer, which
I don't know. I probably would have said no. Like, I was so focused on training for a long time. Like, I just wasn't thinking about anything else.
No. You mentioned you did some things, and I had written down, you know, like, what's, I guess, well, I've done it on a very small scale before, some of these final tables, but what's for you the biggest challenge just in talking that long and going over a table for 10 hours straight?
Yeah, when you're doing a live stream, I mean, it's a challenge to do exactly what we were just talking about, just to make certain like higher level concepts accessible. It's a challenge to stay interesting. I mean, because a lot of times you have some like repetitive, you know, general things that come up, and you need to try to not say the same thing over and over again, make certain kind of repetitive concepts seem interesting in new ways to talking about them, or and then just try to, it's hard to stay focused, it's hard to stay awake, it's hard to stay interested. I mean, you know, for that long, you know, it's like, you know, you're, it's just, it's, it can get, it can become tedious, it can become, it's a real grind, for sure.
Do you have any plan to get do any more announcing or get back into doing more of that anytime soon here?
I don't have any plan to do it. I if somebody were to approach me with like an opportunity that I thought was like interesting, like I would consider it. But I think my bar for what I consider an interesting, valuable opportunity is relatively high right now. So I don't know. I wouldn't rule anything out, but I would be surprised if I got involved in anything within the next like I don't know, at all again. To be honest.
Really? At all? In any capacity?
I don't plan on being in the poker world for that long, so I don't know.
Oh, interesting. Right. What? So I guess other opportunities. What's arose since the fights ended here?
No opportunities have arose since the fight. I mean, Sam and I were in Jamaica, and that was it. I never really planned on being in poker for that long. Part of the reason I was because when I was married, like, I had like blinders on and I wasn't really pursuing anything else. But since I'm not anymore and I have just more freedom to like pursue things and think about how I want my life to look like, and I'm older now, like I'm going to be 35 this year, you know? And like, I want to be able to like, I don't want to be a dad that's traveling all around and doing stuff like that. So like, I want to set up a situation where I can be around when I have a family.
My dad, huh? Interesting. Little pop.
I mean, I'm 35. It can't be weird to be, you know, you see people like go through and talk about, you know, like Doc Sands, Antonio, a lot of people are dead.
What are you laughing at, Samantha? Bang, bang.
Bang, bang. Yeah, Joey's just like instigator. He's like, kids. Oh, you're talking about kids. Oh, interesting.
You guys think I'm like, hey, come on. Yeah, I set that one up. You're right. I did that one. I apologize. Joe is also a dad. Shoot, don't tell. I am actually a dad. That's correct.
You are a dad?
I am, yeah. Guys in the chat, I see a lot of regulars in the chat today, guys. We got a lot of people out here showing up for the pod. Much love, guys. My buddy Ivan says, Puppy, come on, Mosa, let's party. When are you going to Vegas? Tell him I really like the podcast with Terrence Chan and mad respect again for the great work ethic and MMA fight takes. I know, old news, not old news. Thank you, Ivan. Olivier, he says thank you too, I'm sure.
Thank you, Ivan. Yo, you had Terrence on the pod?
No, he's referring to Terrence and Terrence and Ross did
the audio documentary. Okay.
The audio documentary about the fight with you and JC.
What do you think about that?
I think it's good. I've enjoyed listening to it. I checked it out because my boy Ross worked on it hard and.
Oh, that's your boy?
Yeah, I like Ross. He's cool.
How do you know him? Just whatever, through normal poker channels?
Normal poker channels, yeah. We hung out a couple times at a couple different stops. He also plays the great game of Potlum in Omaha. So, you know,
oh, he does.
I'm incredibly partial to people that are tall and play PLO. So, yeah.
Okay. I'm kind of tall, but I don't play PLO.
It's okay. You play basketball, though. It's even better.
I do.
That's even better here.
Binks is in the fridge. Yo, have you met Binks? Binks is the shit.
What makes this cat the shit, Binks?
Because he, like, wants to hang out with you. He's, like, affectionate. He's, like, he's playful. He's, like, I don't have a lot of experience with cats, but my sense is that cats kind of, like, think they're better than you, like want to, like, chill, like, on some high perch and just, like, laugh at you. But Binks just wants to hang out. I mean, Binks is chill. He's great.
Would you say cats are the high stakes poker player of animals then, or what?
I mean, why? Is that how you view high-stakes poker players?
Some of them.
Oh, yeah, some of them.
They're nice to me. I mean, no, they're all. A lot of them are nice to me. But you know, maybe some. They look up on their perch and they. I mean, maybe
some of them for sure. Some of them for sure.
Most of them are like pumpkins. Someone asked about pumpkin chat.
I can't get into pumpkin. Pumpkin broke my heart. But I'm sure they're all nice to you. Yeah, obviously they're nice to you.
Yeah, they're pretty nice to me. They're probably nice to you. Are they nice to you? Are they trying to get the beat down if they're not nice? Or what's happening?
They're not all nice to me, no, for sure. I think a lot of them don't like me at all.
I know my buddy Ryan Fee. You guys.
What is his deal? I don't understand his deal.
I don't know either.
Yeah, I don't know.
I was at his house last night. I'm like, what the hell is going on with you and Olivia? Where are you? Like, what's... He's like, I don't. I'm like, what are you talking about?
Wait, does he know? Does he have a reason, or he just is like, whatever?
I'm not sure. I can't figure it out. I don't know. I'm not sure. I gotta get this. I'm like, what if you guys see each other in Vegas, man? What if he throws you in the fucking headlock, kid, and takes you down? And what are you gonna do?
Headlock? The fuck is that?
Well, what would you do? What would you do then? You wouldn't do a headlock. Well, I mean, it seems like a safe way not to hurt someone too bad. You know, you put him in a headlock.
I don't want to hurt him. I don't care enough to hurt him. He's the one that has the problem. I don't really have a problem.
Okay. Well, I've been telling you might hurt him. If you see him, I feel like could be a thing.
So don't instigate that stuff.
I'm kidding. It's a dumb guy to tell him that. I'm kidding, Olivia.
I did have a small problem with somebody. I'm not going to say who they are. I did have a small problem with somebody. They were fucking with Sam, and I'm not cool with that.
Oh, okay. Well, I already know who that is.
Yeah, so. I know you do, but don't say who it is.
I won't say anything else. No, I actually told Ryan I was going to be like the Reverend Shaka Khan, who's like the mediator, I believe, amongst the hip-hop or black community. And he brings, when there's conflict and then there's beef, he brings them together and sits them down at the fucking table and they solve their conflict. He's just like a reverend chef. I don't know, something like that. And
I don't know what there is to mediate.
Could be. I'm not sure either. Maybe. I don't know. End the violence. I just want to end the violence. You know, that's all I want to do. I just want to end the violence, man. That's all I got to say. Let me get to the, what else we got here on the thing. All right. Oh yeah, did you see the contest that Poker Central did leading up to the event?
Where you had to pick the order of the players that they were going to finish?
Correct. The $1 million contest, aka the $10,000 contest plus 25 MV movement watches that they gave out, where whoever got the closest to picking the final table in order. I know, Chad, I know that's not the real name of the person. I know it's not Shaka Khan. But you had to pick whoever got closest to picking. I don't know what the person's name is. I made up the name.
I love that you got corrected on that.
Yeah, I mean, it can't be the right person. Well, you know, I mean, our demographic and our audience is mainly white people and Asians, so I'm not surprised that, you know, we didn't get corrected, but whatever. But yeah, the person who picked it, I thought it was a great contest because it was a good way to get the word out there on Facebook and on Twitter for a lot of people who may not
risk any money because there was, like, no chance of anybody actually getting all the right.
Right, there was no chance for someone to get them all right to win the million, but somebody does win $10,000 for sure. That's
the person who gets closest wins 10K.
Right, the person that gets closest wins 10K 100% of the time.
And then what else do they win? What were you talking about, the watches?
The top 25 people each won a credit for a movement watch, MVMT, I believe it's called. And the watches are pretty nice. So I thought that was a really cool opportunity.
I didn't know that. Oh, that is cool. Yeah, that's I should have done it. Now I feel stupid for not doing it.
Yeah, it's like free. I mean, you're going to watch it anyway. You might as well do it.
It's going to be hard, though, because I'm always going to pick my boy Danny to win. So.
Well, if I would have filled one out, I would have picked Dan to win. He was my pick on my fantasy team. And
was he?
Yeah, of course.
Why is that of course?
You got to pick Dan. You're fucking not pick him. What are you talking about, man? Am I not supposed to pick him?
All right. Cool. Yeah.
I you know what I did was my strategy was I just want to pick my favorite people on the podcast. So I picked Ben86. I picked Dan. But instead of picking my boy Fedor, the young prince, I picked Connor instead. Because I like Connor a lot.
And
Connor Drynan, yeah.
He's a boss.
Yeah. And unfortunately, Connor got showered early and the young prince got second. So
I mean, Fedor's on another level, man. Kid's on fire.
He's definitely on fire, my friend. He's definitely on fire. But yeah, I thought the contest was good. I thought it was great promotion. I thought it's something that
it was smart.
Yeah, it's just something that I feel like we don't necessarily see much of in terms of promotion and in terms of promoting things in the poker world right now. So I thought it was a cool idea. I thought it probably
who's in charge of this stuff.
Poker Central.
Yeah, but I mean, who are the people? Are the people like that are known in the poker world that are?
I believe Poker Central was founded by Kerry Katz, who plays a lot of high roller events, and then the team working under him. I don't know much about the team. I believe they
Kerry Katz like owns Poker Central or runs Poker Central.
I believe that's correct. I believe he is the main.
I knew he was involved. I knew financially he was involved, but he's like he makes the decisions and stuff. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he makes it. I would imagine he makes decisions if he's
cool.
Invested in poker. So he plays the 25Ks. I think he's one of the driving forces behind those events at the Aria. So I would
for sure.
You know, I assume he's knowledgeable about what's happening and in terms of making decisions. So, but yeah, I think Poker Central is doing a great job. You got the new shows. You got Pokerography that's been a couple episodes out. You got the final table, I believe, is coming out. They got the Poker Report with Donnie Peters coming out too. So. I think those are actually already out, but yeah, it's just, once again, it's the ease of accessibility to actually watching the panel is pretty hard right now.
Yeah, I haven't seen any of the new content. Can I like go watch old stuff like on something?
So I don't exactly know how. That's a great question. I don't know how. I think you have to download something on Apple TV or Roku or
what?
I don't know. Like, it's a great. I'm just not sure. Like, you can't really watch it on YouTube. The clips that they have are just really short clips, like little sound bites to get you interested in it, so that you go seek out how to get the app or watch it. So I think that's the hardest part right now is just finding the content for people.
What is this thing on top of the cable box?
It's like a DVR thing.
A DVR thing.
But it has all the apps. It's just not like I don't know what it is. I just discovered that on YouTube.
All right, let's get Apple TV.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks.
Anything
else? Back to you, Joey.
Tim said Kerry Katz is in the college loan business, so he has plenty of money.
Yeah, student loans. Yeah, I knew that. Yeah, I like Kerry. We always get into like very interesting political discussions. Not really that interesting, but heated.
What's up here? Leading up to that. Oh yeah, I wrote down some things to potentially. Yeah, I thought they did a pretty poor job of really showing the action on the outer tables. When they cut to the outer tables, they didn't really show the whole cards. They had a camera that was sort of like off to the side in a really weird angle. It seemed like they could have done a bit better job of just making that action easier to follow and maybe even going to the outer tables a bit more.
I actually disagree. I hated it every time they went to the outer tables.
Why?
I mean, I think because of what you're describing, because they didn't do a good job with it. So every time they went to the outer tables, you just see two people sitting around. You see, like, their hands face up, and they just, like, run out of board. And you're like, okay, what the fuck? Like, that was not interesting at all. I mean, you see who wins and who loses, but that's it. I mean, I hate every time they went. And they would go to the outer table sometimes when, like, the feature table was in the middle of an interesting hand. I was like, wait, stop. I want to see what this guy does, you know? So, I mean,
exactly.
I don't know. It would be amazing if every table was a feature table and the viewers could choose. Like, you could choose on your own TV. They had, like, you know, like, if there was, like, five or six tables, they had five or six sets of commentators, each commentating, like, one table, and you could just choose which one you were watching.
Ooh. I like that.
I don't know how logistically that sounds super expensive and like just not doable, but whatever.
It does sound pretty. I mean, it sounds really like a sick idea. I love that idea. I did like how they rotated featured tables, so that way it wouldn't be, you know, even sure you might have liked some tables better than others, but I like the chance to get to watch more players. So I really like that they rotated it out.
I thought that was smart, but I felt like they didn't. Like I felt like they didn't rotate that much. I don't know. I felt like there was a table on, I don't know what day it was. I think day two, with like Danny and Truth Teller sitting next to each other. I was like, come on, like fucking get to that table, you know, before these two guys bust punting their stacks up. And I was like, you know, let's fucking start the day with Truth Teller and Danny like right next to each other. Come on, let's do this.
Yeah, I'm sure that they. I'm not sure. It didn't seem like they really had an approach the first day. I think they were just sort of rotating tables, but it seemed like the second day they may have focused on bigger names a bit more.
Yeah, like Helmuth.
Right. Negreanu, I believe, was at the table for a while too.
Yeah. And that makes sense. I mean, they're trying to make, it's, you know, it's all about trying to make money. Yeah. That's why, you know, when people were talking about, I'm switching subjects here. When people talk about, like, a couple people, different people were like, oh, you need to give credit to Poker Night in America for trying to promote women in poker. Like, that's the biggest bullshit ever. Like, they're not trying to promote women in poker. They're trying to make money. And they think having women, especially attractive women at the table, is going to make them more money. It's not like if they were going to sacrifice their profit to put women at tables or to promote women in poker, that would be one thing. But they're not doing it despite profitability. They're doing it because of profitability. You know, it's like they don't deserve credit for that. It's just, I don't know. I thought it was ridiculous.
Sorry. Will you be boycotting Poker Night America as well, Olivier?
You have to be invited to be boycotted.
Bang, bang.
I've never been invited on the show. I don't know. I was just like, what? I don't even want, whatever.
So you've seen that all in time. You've seen that discussion that's happened recently on the.
I'm not blind. I can read. I watched the pod. I didn't watch all of it with her, but I watched the beginning of it. I had to do some shit. I don't remember what it was, but I watched the beginning of it. Yeah.
Yeah. What? What's your take on things from that situation? Be careful. Be careful.
Yeah. No, I know. Trust me. Yeah. I'm gonna take my time right now.
Be careful. They're coming. This is a sensitive stuff. Go ahead.
The thing I love about this conversation is that it's essentially like a lose-lose conversation. There's like no way to like really to like not get shit. But that's okay. I don't mind that. I thought there were some like meta points that people made that were like valuable and important. Like generally speaking, in situations like this, there's this tendency to try to blame the victim. I think showing solidarity and sympathy for someone expressing, you know, talking about this experience is like, should be the number one default answer. And I think a lot of people didn't do that. I obviously don't know like how much of her story was true or not true. I felt like I was convinced by the text messages relating to the interaction with Nolan Dalla. I felt like that guy who made that comment about no Jews on the show was just so insane. Like it's insane for him to say it, and it's insane for her to make it up. Like everything about that is just insane. That just blew me away. And isn't it even true that that's not even an accurate statement, that there are like a number of Jewish people that are affiliated or work with the show? Like, I just don't know. I found Sean Deeb like pretty credible, to be honest, in his denial of that particular conversation. And I think it's, you know, I don't know. I can, you know, Sean says a lot of like needly things, you know, but I don't know. It seems super strange to me that he would say something unprovoked on that level. And I think it does take a lot of like, I don't know, courage is a word that's thrown around a lot, but like courage for her to like come out and speak up, knowing that this was like going to be a shitstorm, especially in the poker world. I mean, it's like if any world does not know how to deal with a situation like this, it's the poker world. You know, it's a world that combines like male dominance with a complete and utter lack of professionalism, right? I mean, it's like, you know, these series of interactions were supposed to be in the context, in a professional context. But the truth is, nothing is a professional context in the poker world. I mean, it should be, obviously, it should be. But I mean, it's just, you know, the poker world is just, it's not, you know, it doesn't have a level of professionalism in any situation that like rivals or that, you know, can be compared to like a normal level of professionalism that people encounter in the real world. And maybe that's also part of, you know, I think she's what? She used to be a scientist or something, or a doctor or something. I mean, she has like a legitimate professional background, right?
Right, right.
And there's a lot of people who are like making comments who just like have never been in the professional world before. They just have no idea. They're just like, oh yeah, when you're at a bar with someone and they're drunk, sometimes someone does some stupid shit. Like, no, dude, no. Like, that's not the attitude. That's not the point of view to have. It's completely fucked up. I also, though, found certain aspects to at least her blog to be that I just found like they didn't serve her particularly well. Like, for example, she said that she expected from her point of view, her invitation on the show was entirely a result of her kind of poker credentials. Really? I mean, I'm not trying to be a dick, but like, I didn't understand. I didn't understand how she doesn't also understand that part of the reason she was invited on the show is because she represents diversity, right? Because there aren't many women on the show, and you know, part of the reason you're invited on the show is because you're a woman. I mean, that's not an insult to you. That's just an analysis of the situation. I mean, it's just like, come on. There are plenty of extremely good, extremely talented poker players who were not invited on the show or not on the show. So, I mean, I just thought that would, like, that lack of awareness or that, like, unwillingness to, like, confront that part of the situation, I thought was odd to me. I also thought not talking openly about how she interacted with the money was just, it just strategically didn't make sense. It just was not smart. Like, if you know that they have this information, you know this information is going to come out, you need to just put it out there. Talk about it. Acknowledge it, talk about what your point of view was, and then move on. It doesn't excuse the behavior, but when you don't talk about it or when it seems like you're hiding it, then I'm not sure, you can't be that surprised when people start to attack your credibility, right? Because I mean, in this situation, credibility is very important because there's not a lot of proof either way. So it's just kind of like, do people believe you or not? That's really what we're talking about, whether people believe you. A lot of people said that they believe her, and for some instances, do believe her. But if you start, you know, if you're saying, you know, in her blog, she says, you know, my integrity, like, was more important than money. Basically, like, my integrity didn't have a price or something like that to that effect. And then there's an email saying that you demanded a lot of money to be quiet. I mean, that's a problem. It's not a problem that means that you didn't have these interactions. It's not a problem that means that those situations were acceptable or that you weren't a legitimate victim. But in the court of public opinion, I'm not surprised that some people had a problem with that. And I also felt that some people defending her misrepresented the views of people who were attacking her, being like, you know, like not taking the point that I just made seriously. Like, that's a real point, I think. And you have to just acknowledge it. Even if you believe her, even if you want to defend her, that's fine. But I mean, I thought some of the people who were attacking her, I thought they were, a lot of them were dicks. A lot of them came out of nowhere with no, you know, they didn't know what the hell they were talking about and should have kept their mouth shut. But, you know, not all of them were just like mindless trolls or just, you know, like some of them were making real points and had, you know, and, you know, the fact that all these interactions happened that hadn't really happened to other people with these people, but it happened to her in a short period of time. It makes it a little bit more difficult to believe. Doesn't mean it's not true, whatever, but yeah, you can't be shocked when some people are like, you know, they just question it. Mm. Anyway, whatever. Mm. I'm sure my people are going to not like that answer, but.
Yeah, well done. Well done, kid. I feel like you navigated that in a very GTO manner, my friend.
I don't know if I did.
Nah, you did. You did. You navigated it well. I mean, yeah, I get, you know, I don't know. I don't really want to talk too much about it because I've been talking about it to way too much these past, since I did the last podcast. I got to say, that podcast, that was the most messages I've ever gotten in my entire life.
Yeah.
After, where I wrap that up, like everywhere, everyone messaged me like, what do you think? You believe her? Is it true? What do you think? Like, what's your take on the situation? I'm just like, man, I like, you know, I don't know.
What do you think about the fact that you've gotten to a point now where people really care what you think? What do you think about that?
It's interesting. It's interesting. Like it? I mean, I guess that's when you start doing the podcast. You know, like that's sort of what.
I mean, she could have done interviews with a bunch of different people, podcasts. She went on your podcast first, right?
Yeah, she went on mine first. Yeah.
Look at you, puppy.
Yeah. Well, I feel like there's a reason why, but.
Yeah, yeah. Tell me what you think the reason why is.
Yes, tell us.
Tell everybody, huh? Can I tell you after?
Tell us.
I feel like I'll tell you guys after.
Oh my god, man! You are you get on the spotlight and you're just like, what a wimp you are.
Shy. I'm shy, guys. Come on, look how red I am.
You're so shy.
Is that the sunburn or is that redness in my face? I mean, come on.
I don't know. Shout out to you.
That's why. No, I think because all right, fine. I think because
do it.
Okay, I'll tell. All right, fine. So,
I know.
A long time ago, I read some of her writing, and I reached out to her because I was thinking about writing more stuff too, and it was something poker related. And we started having a conversation, and then I found out her boyfriend used to be the short stacking motherfucker who used to play as stars all the time in the full ring games. And so I started talking to him because we used to play a ton together.
Start talking to him. What does that mean? You just call him a short stacking motherfucker. So when you start talking to him, what are you saying?
Listen, I used to have a lot of hate for short stackers. Now I don't mind him. Shout out to the short stackers. So I was just talking to him. I was like, man, you still short
stacking. Shout out to the short stacking motherfuckers.
Yeah. I was like, man, you still one of those short stacking motherfuckers or what, man? Like, what are you doing with yourself? And he said sometimes he does. He short stacks the games live and whatever. That's fine. I got love. But yeah, we just talked.
Yo, whatever. That's fine. That's great.
Yeah, I kept a relationship with her because I enjoyed some of her writing, and I would talk to her and her boyfriend from time to time, and she played some blogs.
Writing, what does that mean? This is like her blog that she was writing about different. What was she writing about?
It was just I think it was she wrote some things in a couple card player stuff like magazine type of stuff like that, and there was something that we talked ideas on for one thing. I think it was either she was doing something or I was thinking about writing something, and we talked about that too. But yeah, I do a really good job of keeping in touch with people, just messaging people saying like, hey, how's it going, or you know, seeing what people are working on, or giving some feedback, or maybe getting feedback in an area that they're maybe more knowledgeable about something than I am. And so for her, she would send me photos of people watching my podcast in the live 5-10 games in Florida too. So I would always I thought it was hilarious that there was like, there'd be sometimes like two people watching the podcast as they're playing 5-10 live in the game she was playing. So, but yeah, so I just kept a relationship with her and yeah, I think she knows that the pod is a place where, I don't know, I guess that I feel like she thinks I give people a fair, I'm not critical of someone. I'm not going to, you know, be some type of way with somebody. I'm going to give them a place to talk openly about whatever. And
no, I thought you were great. I thought you were great. You led her to like, you know, to have a coherent story, and you challenged her, but you weren't like a dick or, I mean, I thought you were good, man.
Yeah. I mean, obviously it's a tough one because there's, you know, that there's so many people watching that never watch the podcast. They don't know anything about you. They don't know your style. They don't know anything. They don't know anything about you or what type of person you are. They don't even know about what your poker or anything is. They just know the story. And you obviously you want to, I feel like I try to not be as serious in the podcast because I'm not a very serious person overall. But with that one, I felt like it was better to.
No, you had a different tone.
More serious about it because it's a very important topic. And I think it's a topic that's very serious to many people out there too.
No, it's a serious topic for sure. Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I also thought some people were just, I mean, it was, people made jokes and like said dumb shit. I mean, it's a real thing. I thought people were a little bit too kind of casual about it in the way that they expressed their opinions and the way that they said what they said. I thought people didn't take it seriously enough, but that's anything but surprising in this community. I mean, like, it's like taking something seriously in this community sometimes is like mockable, you know, it's like everyone's a fucking troll. Nobody gives a shit about anything. It's just like, give me a break. You know, the whole community needs to grow the fuck up, I think. But
you see, I don't even know if it's the community, because it's the people that I've talked to that would be, I guess, more considered, you know, people that are recognizable in poker. I've had some really good conversations with a lot of different people. And
I have too, but that's because I'm sure your conversations are biased by the people that you're having them with.
That's a fair point.
And the high stakes community is great. I mean, the high stakes community is like, I mean, there are a lot of fucking dope people.
I definitely agree. Yeah. The chat. Come on, guys. They said the girl looks 13.
What? Which girl?
Sam?
What the fuck?
Sam's 24, guys. Come on, she's been
25, first of all.
Wait, come on, I thought we were friends.
Didn't she know her birthday passed?
Are you 25?
Wishing her a happy birthday? Holy fucking shit.
Yeah.
What, are you going to check your fucking Facebook or something? What are you doing right now? She trusts me.
How am I supposed to know when her goddamn birthday is, Olivia?
Was she her friend? I don't know.
You can read the poker listings article she was mentioned in, man. Come on.
I also wished her a happy birthday on Twitter. I don't know where you were. You probably favorited that tweet, too. I'm pretty sure you did, actually.
Is that true? Hold on a second. I gotta check it. I gotta Google this. Hold on.
I really want to go to my. Yeah, I want to see that. I'm pretty sure you favorited that tweet. You probably reached.
I don't even remember that day.
Shocker.
Why does your birthday come up on Google when I Google your birthday? That's that seems weird.
Why doesn't it?
It does. It comes up first. It's like, it just says it at the top. Like, look at this. It says.
There you go.
Well, it's pictures. It says date of birth. That whoa. It says date of birth right here. The first thing is a
too close.
Yeah, will it come up? No, fuck it, whatever. But yeah, you guys can Google it yourself and find out. I want to Google your name and see if it comes up, or I guess we'll Google someone.
Why don't you Google your own name? To leave my name out of Google.
I hope it doesn't. Hold on, I'm gonna be worried.
my name when it comes up married.
No,
I'm pretty sure it does. Yeah.
Are you still married?
No. No.
It could be legally. You never know. I don't know how things work. Oh, your birthday comes up August 22nd, 1981. Shout out to you, puppy.
Shout out to Leo's. Yeah, all over the place.
Very nice. Very nice. All right. I got a couple more things about this about the high roller event. We needed more tatty tats, obviously. I just wanted to see more Tatiana. Shout out to her. I technically am staying at her and McLean's place right now. So I am
Technically.
Well, technically I am.
You actually are staying there.
Literally on the couch right now. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm at their the shout out to them. They're very gracious hosts, Tatiana and McLean. McLean Carr, shout out to McLean. And but yeah, I think I'm gonna do a pod with Tatiana as well sometime soon, because it'll be fun. And but yeah, we need a more Tatiana. What you think about, I mean, you're not gonna say anything bad. What you think about Jesse Sylvia and Kara Scott as the hosts of the show, the hosts?
All right.
Yeah, I love Kara. You know, I worked just a little bit on the World Series. I thought, like, I personally, I've done those segments for the World Series, like when I was essentially like demoted from commentator, like Antonio took over, and they like were like, oh, let's look for a spot. Maybe you can like talk during the breaks. And those are super difficult. It's a super difficult position to be in. I thought Jesse like did a pretty good job, but it's hard. I mean, it's really hard. You're like, the questions are kind of open-ended, and the question is like, hey, what are your thoughts from the last level? And it's like, I don't fucking know what my thoughts were. You know what I mean? Like, poker happened, you know, some people won some pots. Like, it's a really tough question to answer. And I don't mean that about like Kara's answer. It's just, it's a segment that doesn't lend itself very well to like a flowing conversation. You know, you don't have that much time, and you're trying to just kind of react to what happened. I mean, unless something crazy or specific happens, I think it's really tough. It's a tough position to be in. I thought there were times where it was a little bit awkward, but I think most of that is because it's a tough spot to be in.
Yeah. I think especially with Tatiana, so she was doing these 45 second pieces or, you know, so it's like, and it's live too. So you have to like be on the ball. You can't really stumble your words. You only get a certain amount of time. And I believe she is the one that's preparing those statements too. So I think it's definitely a challenging thing. I don't know much about how exactly the host part works as well, because I haven't really talked with Jesse about it at all. And
I think it's the kind of thing that just it takes experience to become natural at it. Like, I remember when I was doing Alpha 8 with Ali, and it was like, I mean, this is true in the end, but especially in the beginning, I was just like a deer in headlights. I mean, I was just so awkward and uncomfortable, and I just felt so stiff in the chair, and I just like have this shit in my hair, and I'm wearing this fucking suit, and I'm just like, what the fuck? Like, oh, this is super awkward. And Ali is just chilling there as natural as can be. Like, right when the camera gets on, he just flows. When the camera's off, he's making jokes to the, you know, to the cast and the crew. Everyone's just like dying. I mean, he flows so naturally. I mean, part of it is because he's talented, obviously. But also part of it is because he's been doing TV for like 15 years. Right. So, I mean, I think a lot of that stuff, comfortability, you know, with the camera and just like being natural and flowing and stuff, that just comes with just doing it and experience and stuff. It's really hard if you haven't done it for a while.
Yeah. Let me think here. Yeah, I guess that was one thing. Yeah, I think one other thing I wrote down was about the early days. I thought they could have done a bit more to just, I guess, provide some backstories on some of the players, because I just some of the guys, like, I don't know much about. And
like who?
I think it would be a cool way to just, like, tell people more about the players and let them know. And maybe they want to become fans of that person. Maybe they like something about that player, and maybe they want to follow the player. It just seems like it would be an easy way to build up new people in poker, or just add more information about certain people who are maybe on that middling tier in terms of popularity in the United States in the poker world, and maybe just help take them. Because if you have more stars, if you have more well-known people, well, then you have more fans that want to pay attention to those people too. So I thought that could have been something that thought about for future kind of situations like that.
I think that's actually a really, really good point. I was one of the things, I mean, that's one of the suggestions I made actually to Alpha 8. That's a completely different situation because they have time to, like, really explore people. Whereas in this tournament, it's hard to explore people because everything is live. But, like, if you could go to, like, Byron Kamerman's house or something, like, you know, if he's training for this triathlon, just, like, kind of look into a little bit of what how he's training, like, talk to some people who are friends with him, or just, like, really kind of get into his life and get to know him a little bit. Like, I totally agree. Creating characters is, like, it's great for people to root for or root against. Mm-hmm. It gives people a vested interest. And it just connects people more to the poker. So I completely agree with that. I think it's a little bit tough in the context of the coverage starts at the beginning of the tournament, ends at the end of the tournament. They could do some interviews with people. But I think also a lot of times when they do interviews, it's like short interviews, and the interviews are about the poker. What did you think about yesterday? What were you thinking about this hand? And I think they should try to get away from that and get more, like, have you ever seen, American Warrior Ninja or whatever?
American Ninja Warrior.
Ninja Warrior. Yeah, sorry. So, like, in that show, like, before people go, they, like, go, you know, a lot of times to introduce them to the audience, they do a whole little segment on them where they go to where they live, where they train. They talk about their family. They talk about, like, stuff about them. And it's, right. Like, it's very different experience when you watch them go through this obstacle course knowing a little bit about them. You know, sometimes you're like, oh, that guy kind of seems like a dick. Or you're like, oh, wow, she seems really, really cool. Like, I really hope she gets this. I mean, that's just a natural part of, like, you know, getting to know someone in that situation. So I think poker should definitely – televised poker should definitely try to implement that.
Good call. Two things. One, this player list was known for months ahead of time, I believe. Yes. People reserve seats, yeah, too. And also, I think that's what makes – so speaking about commentating, I think that's where having a commentator who is familiar with the players really helps, because when you know the players –
Don't you think that was true of Nick?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure how much he really plays with those guys. Yeah, I don't know how much he might be in tune with some of the online guys. I don't know how much he might be in tune with what's happening with some of the online world and that sort of thing.
I felt like almost every time a person came up, Nick had experience playing with them. I actually thought Nick was a great choice from that point of view, because especially those super high buy-in tournaments, you have guys like Berkey who, like, don't really play tournaments. So, like, I've never played with this guy. The only people who have really played with this guy are people that play, like, really high-stakes cash, like, you know, high stakes live cash. And Nick is one of those people. So Nick actually had, like, hand experience. You know, Nick told the story about how Berkey spent, I don't know, a few hours just, like, limping every single hand. I thought that was a fucking cool story. I was like, oh, that's a cool thing that he did. Like, that's awesome. It gives context to Berkey limping in the actual tournament.
That's exactly what I mean by that. Let's just bring him.
And, like, so someone like, I mean, Robel's been around for a long time. But, like, you know, I've played a little bit with Robel in the context of tournaments. But, you know, people who play live, you know, high stakes live cash played a lot more with him. You know, he's a person that I think is, like, you know, you could do some, you know, you could get into his story a little bit. I mean, he's I think he's won a lot of money. He's done some interesting stuff. And there are plenty of other people. I thought Nick, his combination of live cash, a little bit of online, and tournaments made him a really good person to have, like, this, like, web of connections to almost every single player.
Do you think in that situation it matters if both people do, or do you think it doesn't matter?
Both people, you mean Nick and Ali?
Correct, yeah.
I think, yeah, the more connections there are, the better. I mean, I think Ali is as good as you're going to find, you know, assuming that you're picking someone who has TV experience, like real TV experience. I mean, I think if you just pick two people that are exclusively in the poker world, I think you'll find much more awkwardness in the flow of the conversation. I think some people take for granted how Ali is able to carry the conversation, how he steers it, how he kind of overall like navigates the situation. Like he's really, really good at that. I mean, you have to remember, Ali was the sole voice on Poker After Dark. Like, you know how hard it is to be the only voice on a fucking show to do the whole thing by yourself? I mean, he did, you know, I mean, that he knows like how to do that, I think. So I think it's smart to combine someone with real TV experience with someone from the poker world. And from the TV experience point of view, Ali has as much connection to poker as anybody. Not to mention, Ali did Alpha 8 with me. So Ali already knows a bunch of the high stakes guys. Like, there was one time where they were just like kind of like talking off the cuff about people who weren't in the tournament. And he was just like, oh yeah. And he just like started talking about Lucky Chewy, because during Alpha 8, you know, I don't think Ali knows Chewy, but during Alpha 8, they had this whole segment on Chewy and doing yoga and meditation and all of this stuff. And so, like, Ali has that background to be able to pull from when he was talking during this tournament.
Mm. Yeah, I wonder if, I guess hopefully we see him more. Because I feel like with Ali specifically, he hasn't been doing, I guess he was doing the Alpha 8. I don't think I've watched much Alpha 8 because.
Thanks, buddy.
What is it on? Fox Sports 1 or something like that?
Oh, yeah. It's because of the channel. I mean, yeah. I mean, who goes on Fox Sports 1?
Listen, I'm not trying to watch no tournaments, okay? And but, hey, with that
this
said.
This whole fucking podcast is about a tournament.
With that said, this is about, yeah, you're right, man. Shit, man. All right, guys. We're going to have a Twitch marathon later tonight. I'm going to be watching all the Alpha 8 episodes, and I got to support Olivier. Wait a second. Hey, Sam, how many WPT
episodes
you watching?
Oh, my God.
For comparison's sake,
listened to like an interview of mine. She's never heard me do commentary. Sam was like, basically, like, who are you? I don't even know who the fuck you are.
But since then, how many has she watched?
Yeah, none. Still none. She's like, why would I watch that when I can just talk to you right now?
I'm gonna say that too. Then why would I can message you anytime and you'll message me back? Why would I do that? I don't understand.
Fine, whatever.
Sam, what right, did you?
Nobody I know watches. Actually, a couple of my boys like who don't play poker watch Alpha 8. That's pretty much it. Like one of my friends would be like, yo, that was crazy when this happened. I'm like, thank God somebody I know watches this show. My parents don't watch the show. Like, I don't think my brothers ever watched the show. You know, I actually, sometimes I found my, like I found it on my TV sometimes, like randomly, because it's the same channel that like UFC is on, you know?
Right.
But like when I was training, I would like be watching all these fights and then like do something else. And I turn around and like, I hear my own voice. I'm like, I got to turn this shit off. I can't even watch myself.
So you don't even watch yourself. Okay.
Oh, I watched like the first episode and it was really hard to watch. And then the second episode, I think I made through the first half and I was like, I can't watch this shit anymore. I stopped watching. And that was when I was my worst, you know, because I was super awkward and uncomfortable. I'm hoping it got better, but, and also like I did this thing with my hair. I don't know, they really wanted my hair to be a certain way. And I was like, so I had all this product in my hair and it looked all fucking, it was awful.
That's when your hair was longer?
Then my hair was longer, yeah. And so like, I remember one day, like in the second season, I went up to them and I was like, yo, I'm not doing my hair shit anymore. And like the producer was just like, okay, whatever you want. And I was like, oh my God, I could have done this the whole time, fuck. Anyway.
So was your hair kind of like this puppy? Was this how it looked or what?
No, your hair always looks like on point. Your hair looks good. My hair was.
You do have one hair right now.
Though. You do have one hair on the other side. I thought that was on purpose. Was that not on purpose?
Right here? That's on purpose, yeah.
No. Not a little bit in front of that
one.
Yeah, a little bit in front of that one. Yep, that one.
Yeah.
Oh, wait a second. Oh, my God. What the hell? Oh, whoa.
I thought that was supposed to be there. I thought that was like your way of being like, hey, I'm a cool guy. I don't have to do the whole
thing. I am cool, guys. Yeah. Well, it was an accident, but. Samantha, what did you think about the Super High Roller Bowl?
I didn't get to watch the whole thing. I actually didn't watch much of it at all. I watched some of it with Binks yesterday. And
with
then
Binks?
No, yeah, Binks was sweating it hard.
Yeah, Binks was into
and
it.
And then I went to pick up Olivier from the airport, and then we watched some of it at the restaurant. They put it on.
We watched like 10 minutes of it.
But I was trying not to watch it because I didn't want to see spoilers.
She recorded it, though, to watch it.
Yeah, but then I ended up looking anyway.
Yes, Sam. Really great plan to avoid spoilers for this event.
Yeah, we had like a TV at our table, and then across the restaurant there was another large TV, and I felt like everywhere I looked, I was gonna see like chips.
Yeah, but she's not mentioning the fact that when we got there, it wasn't on the TV.
Yeah.
And then the waiter is like likes poker and is like a fan of hers, and was like, "Hey, Sam," like when she walked in, and then 5 minutes later, the poker was on the TV. I was like, "Oh."
I was like, "No, I want to see." And then.
Wait a second. The waiter was a fan of Sam?
Yeah. And a big fan of poker. He's playing Colossus now. He's like into poker.
Did he know who you were, or did he just know Sam?
No, he knew who I was. He asked me why I wasn't playing the tournament, so I think he knew who I was.
Oh.
But I mean, it's become a thing now. Like, this is the thing with me when I was with Danny, like, a couple years ago. Like, we were in this airport together, and somebody like comes up to Danny and was like so excited. He was like, "Oh my God, it's you!" Like, blah 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 blah. And then he turns to me and he's like, "Oh, you're cool too." And I was like, "Cool, that's awesome." And like the same kind of thing happens with Sam. People are like really excited to like meet or be around her, and they're like, "Oh yeah, I've seen you before. That's cool. You're all right."
I feel like it's
I'm overshadowed. I'm cool with it.
Has that been happening a lot since you guys had the unification?
No, I mean, the only place we were in was Tulsa, and then we were in Jamaica. So Jamaica, like, no, nobody knew who either one of us was in Jamaica.
You know? That guy at the pool. Remember?
That guy at the pool?
He like, I gave
the joke. Oh, sorry. And yeah, so in Tulsa, yeah, I mean, Tulsa, everyone was about Sam, but some people were like cool with me, but everyone's about Sam. Can't really blame them, you know.
So people, you should have shown him the fight, kid. You should just bring the fight around on the phone and show. No, it's a fight. It's a fight.
Yeah, that's totally cool. That's not like that's not douchey at all.
Yeah, not at all.
Like, oh, hey, hi, nice to meet you. Watch me fight this guy.
Maybe you need Sam to show the fight to people.
I don't need anything. I'm cool. I'm great. I like the fact that people are excited about meeting Sam. I'm cool with it. I don't. This is not a competition. I would rather be more under the radar. Yeah, for her, it's a competition. I'm happy to let her win, though. It's the only thing she can beat me in.
Bang, bang. Is that true? Hey, whoa. Hey,
I don't know if people know, but, like Sam is super competitive, like, incredibly competitive and super, like, loves games. Like, we play games all the time. It's tough on her. It's tough on her, but it's fun. Really
whoa,
fun.
Whoa, whoa. Scoreboard.
Score, yes. Don't scoreboard it. It's not good for you.
What?
Sorry. Sorry, let's move on.
Have you guys ever played a game called Corridor?
What?
Have you ever played a board game called Corridor?
No.
You
should come over and teach
us. Are you going to teach us?
I mean, I'm going to teach you both at the game, bang, bang. But I mean, hey, we
do. Yeah, you're going to beat us both until either one of us learns, and then we're going to learn, and we're going to crush you. That's what happens. So in the beginning.
I'm excited. I'll play the game. What other game? Stratego. You play Stratego?
Oh, is your girl going to come out?
Yeah. Oh, wait.
What? Sorry. What? What happened?
Which girl are you talking about, Sam?
Yeah.
I know. Well, I was
Balderdash?
Yeah, Balderdash. Yeah.
I've heard of that. I've never played it before.
That was the change of subject I was looking for.
Which girl?
That was really
I don't know. I'm not even going to fuck with that. We can talk later.
Yeah.
What? Is Corridor an old game?
I don't think so. It's like a game where you have to block the other person from getting to the other side, and you have to leave one corridor for them to get there.
Oh, it's called Corridor?
Corridor, yeah.
Oh, I thought, okay.
It's a board game. Settlers of Catan. You ever played Settlers of Catan before?
I've heard of that. I heard it's like in the category of games that I like.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Have you ever played Resistance?
No, I haven't.
Well, that game is dope. I'll show you that game. Time actually that game to me.
We can play Sharks and Minnows. We can play Marco Polo. We need pool games.
What are those games?
Where are you staying?
Are you serious? Yeah, where are you? Are you going to be close to us?
Probably at Vidara, I would assume, which is right next to you.
Yeah, it's really close.
Can you walk?
Yeah, it's right there.
I don't know how to walk from here to anywhere.
I'll show you.
Yeah, you go through Aria and then...
Aria. I'm looking at Aria. It looks super far away from here.
It's not. It's like a 3-minute walk.
Really?
Yeah.
Because you don't go on the ramp. You just go, there's like a back way.
Okay.
It's pretty close. It's good. Guys in the chat, a couple questions and we got to wrap it up. I was trying to keep this under an hour. It never works out how I imagine.
What time is it? 3:45. Yeah, that's not right. Yeah, we need to eat. You going to watch this basketball game, Joey?
Of course, definitely. What time? A game's at
soon, right? It's at 5, right?
Or 5. I think it's 5 or 6.
Games at 5 and the game's at 5:30 maybe?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Yeah. Have you played the Game of Things?
Yo, have you ever played Game of Thrones, the board game?
I've heard about that, but no, I haven't played it.
That's an epic game. Epic. Like, you need fucking you need to take a while to learn it, and then you need to set aside a time, like time to play it, because that shit takes forever. But it's a dope game.
Have you guys just been playing games the entire like past like month or something?
Like what we do, yeah.
That's our thing.
That's what we do. I mean, I was playing Scoop. She wasn't, but I was.
I love, yeah, dude, I love how Sam's a professional poker player and, like, watching you play Scoop and not, and, like, Snapchatting you playing Scoop. I'm like, wait, why aren't you playing Scoop, too? Like, I mean, aren't you? Like,
she needs to get a PokerStars account. It's not so easy.
Yeah, I never had one. Remember, it was before my time.
Sam's just been crushing the live games.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, whatever. Scoop went well.
What are your plans? Are you going to play PLO this summer? Or, like, what are you doing?
Two options. One, drink a lot and go out every night with all the Europeans. Two, play a lot of poker, play a lot of PLO cash, and then play the PLO tournaments. Three, and maintain my diet and maintain my workouts. And also rock climb and do sports and be at
Well, let's, yo, do you want to train together?
Yeah, let's do that. Okay. For sure.
You can come here.
Are you going to be doing fighting stuff too, or are you just going to be lifting?
No, I'm going to be doing fight stuff too, but I want to do like basic upper body stuff and then like serious like lower body lifting. Like I was talking to Raptor about it. He wants to do that too. And it's like,
oh, yeah,
if we play, we can like alternate days we don't play basketball, or we can do some upper body stuff before basketball games. Like we can do a bunch of stuff. And UNLV's gym is dope. And there's a gym here too you can use.
But I want to
go ahead, Sam.
He wants to go climbing.
She wants to play?
She wants to go climbing.
Climbing with you.
Oh, climbing. Yeah, climbing's fun. Yeah, you've never done it, Olivia, you said, right?
I've never done it. I want to do it. I'm down to go. I'm down to go.
Yeah, it's fun. I mean, it's probably a little fucking hot outside, but it'll be fun.
It's outside?
Well, yeah, the rock will be too hot probably, but there's two indoor gyms where we can boulder.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, I think the times that I've seen out there on Red Rock, the outside ones.
Let's go boulder. Just do this. We're going to do some bouldering. I don't know.
You'll probably like it. I mean, I'll say, Olivia, when I climb, I feel like it's kind of like, it's like one-on-one. You're one-on-one with the wall, and you're trying to figure out how to navigate up the wall and, like, beat the wall. That's sort of like the way I view things when I,
that's
when
cool. I climb. I'm sure I'll like it. I don't know if my – what part of you needs to be strong? You need really good, like, body weight strength, right?
I mean, I think so. I think it's a lot. I mean, it could be if you don't have the technique and fundamentals, then you can overcome some things with strength. But I think technique is pretty important too.
I'm sure it's very important. I just know that my technique will be weak, especially in the beginning. So I'm just like, but the strength that's required is grip strength and like lower body strength.
I'm not 100% sure.
I think legs are important, right? I think that's one of the things that I heard, that like legs are undervalued. Most people think it's upper body strength and that's like relevant, but legs are important. And then obviously grip is super important, I'm assuming.
Yeah, you should be good then. Are your legs really strong? Did you train your legs a lot before during the fight?
Yeah, but that's like my legs are decent, but they were weak when I tore my ACL and I didn't train legs that much before that. So my legs were weak and they got to a point where they're like decent now, but I want to get them strong. They're not strong yet.
Now, I've been lifting mine pretty heavy too with deadlifts lately. So I'm trying to, and squats, but now I can't go that heavy in squats yet because I'm a noob. But deadlifts, I can go a lot heavier.
No, are you trying to get your jumps, your hops up?
No, I know you and Raptor are probably trying to dunk now, but I'm sure you guys talked about some sort of dunking prop bet like you talked with me about.
No, I'm not trying to, but I'm not into prop bets, really. I was just saying we could like do some stuff specifically geared towards being able to jump higher if you want.
No, there's an app. It's called Flight something. I was one of my cousin's boyfriend used it, and he's like 5'8" white kid, and he used it to be able to dunk, and I trained him a couple times, and that was some of the hardest leg workouts I've done for jumping.
Awesome. Okay.
So we can check
what
that out.
What is it called?
I think it's called like, it's by some 5'5" kid named Brandon Todd. I don't remember the exact name, but if anyone's out there trying to dunk, you can check it out, guys. It's called Flight something.
Flight something, okay. Yeah, I'll look into that. I mean, I'm super old now, so it's going to be tough.
Yeah, it would. That's what I mean. Flight right. Yeah, that's what it's called. Flight right. I mean, I feel old too, Poppy. So
you feel old? Yeah. Okay, that's my point. You feel old. You're 5 years younger than me.
That's a good point.
Fuck you. You were supposed to say that's not a good point.
I mean,
you're not supposed to disagree with me.
We've all seen you with your shirt off less than months ago. You're in good shape. Come on.
Yeah, that's a good point. You are fucking old as hell.
You're doing okay over there, buddy. You're doing okay. Guy, we get any questions in here? Hold on.
Joey, are you still watching this, or is it just German people? What's going on?
Well, I think they have a Periscope link. I believe they found Squirter 69's been Periscoping.
69, man or she? I don't know.
Yeah. No. What do you think about the Jason Mercier versus Doug Polk beef?
Oh yeah, let's get into that.
I mean, first of all, I like both of those guys. I think I actually much prefer the way Jason handled it. Like, I think Jason talked about how he like regretted getting into it with Doug, like, because, you know, Doug came at him, I guess, and then Jason like responded, making some challenges, and I think Jason regretted doing that, which I was like, yeah, I agree that was not the best way to like come back. He should have just like ignored it or just like made a joke of it instead of like getting offended and then coming back. Doug, though, like, I don't know. Yo, first of all, the thing that you and I both retweeted today, that interview that the guy did to
Franco Ford.
Amazing. Like, you guys need to check that shit out, because we were dying at that. That was awesome. That was super brilliant. Funny. But I think, you know, I heard a couple things that Doug said about it, which I just think are not – they either, like, lack some self-awareness or they're just, like, kind of not particularly honest, where he was just, like – you know, like, he was – you know, one of the things he said was, like, you know, can I just, like, label him a bad reg? Like, don't I just have the right to do that? Like, first of all, sure, you have the right to do that, but let's not pretend like you didn't do that purposefully, knowing that people were going to see, knowing that there was some shock value associated, knowing you were going to stir up some controversy. Like, and it's not like it's a note that's helpful. It's not like, oh, Jason comes to the table now and you like look at your notes and you're like, bad reg. Oh yeah, thanks. I'm glad I remembered that. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know who the fuck Jason is. And when he shows up at your table, if you don't think he's good, you don't need that note to remind you. Like, that's just like, that, I mean, so I thought that was a little bit like, come on, man. Like, who are you trying to fool right now with, like, I just had a note, you know, just like one of my notes, you know? So I thought that was a little bit bullshit. And I also thought, like, you know, it's a way of, like, elevating yourself and your crew to attack someone at the level of Jason. Like, you know, I just think, first of all, I think Doug and his crew have a little bit too narrow a view of what it means to be good at poker. I think they discount certain elements. And I think those elements are particularly like relevant to Jason and his form of being good or edge or whatever. I think it's pretty undeniable like how much talent Jason has. He's just good at everything. You know, he's real sharp, like super sharp at this particular thing. I mean, it's just, he's really, really good. So, I mean, is he not on the same level theoretically as Doug? Like, yeah, okay. Neither is anybody else. I mean, you know, and I think the thing about the heads up tournament, like I didn't play that fucking tournament. Like, that tournament was probably the toughest tournament in the history of poker. It was so tough. So, like, yeah, I don't think Jason has an edge in that tournament, and that's not a way of insulting Jason. It's just, it's a fucking super tough tournament. So, whatever. So there's that. And then what else was I going to say? I think I was going to say one more thing. Oh, yeah. I also think, like, Doug, he restricts the use of the word good. You know, most people are like, okay. Like, if he calls you okay, that's like a fucking compliment. You know, most people are okay. Or most, like, some people are okay, and then most people are just, like, such shit, you know? They're clueless. They don't know what the fuck's going on, you know? They're just, like, such shit. But a couple people every once in a while are good, you know? And so he's, like, very, you know, he really, being good is a scarce resource coming from Doug. And I think it's a little bit biased because at the end of the day, like, all his friends are good, right? He thinks all his friends are good. And then he thinks a couple people here and there are good. I think the chances of that actually being true are pretty low. But whatever. I mean, it is what it is. A lot of it was like ego and stupidity. But I thought that them putting those tweets during the tournament, I thought was like a little bit ridiculous. I thought it made the players look really petty and small. And I just didn't think it was like a particularly good representation of poker. You know, I think some people have the point of view that if something is relevant, if something is interesting, it's fair game, no matter what it is. If, you know, Phil Hellmuth is entertaining, so that's good. It's good for poker because more people are watching it. And I just think the nature of the thing itself matters. I think representing the community and specific people in ways that elevate them rather than, you know, put them down is a key distinction. And it's a distinction that I'm just not a fan of times where you're just like, we make our community look like petty and just like childish or just like whiny or just shitty. I mean, I'm just not a fan of that.
Non-stop like
that. Yeah. And it happens, like shit like that happens all the time. And I think part of the reason for that is because it's easy. That's like the easy shit to do. It's the low hanging fruit, so to speak, of entertainment. It's just like a guy's a dick or, you know, these guys are talking shit to each other. And it's just like, I don't know. I think we can be better than that. So, whatever. That's where I'm at. You feel me? But I did think it was kind of funny that they were sitting next to each other. That was kind of funny.
Yeah, I thought it was hilarious that they were sitting next to each other. And at the feature table, Doug just kept talking like nonstop. And I was like, man, I can't imagine what, well, like Mercier is thinking right now during all this is when, especially when I think Doug bluffed Brian Rast in a big pot and then he showed it and then he's like, bazam. And then, yeah, I was like, man, Rast must be tilted as fuck. I mean,
I don't think Rast is that tilted, man. Rast was telling me about this fucking biking prop bets that he did. Yo, Rast just sharked everybody in these bets.
I know. I didn't think he was, but
I don't know if people realize Rast made all the money. He said he's going to write a blog, so I'm not going to blow his spot up. But yo, yeah. Rast just sharked fucking mad people for a lot of money. So. Yeah, I think Rass is doing all right. Brian was just playing basketball with us.
Is he any good at ball?
He's all right.
Yeah. Who was the best player out there today?
Fucking Kyle's the man.
Yeah, Kyle Julius is fucking sick.
Kyle, he was on. He was like, he didn't even say, he said he wasn't even like feeling good or whatever. He is on point. I mean, that kid is on a different level from everyone else. He said he has a one-on-one prop bet with Charlie Hook. Do you know who Charlie Hook is? Charlie Hook is a East Coast grinder, nice kid. Big dude. I think he played some college ball. I think he's like 6'4". He's probably like 210, 220. He's a big guy. But they have like a 25K prop bet. I think Charlie's drawing pretty thin. Kyle's fucking good, man. Real, and Kyle said they agreed to make it take it. I think it's like 25K. Make it take it, which is just like, it's going to be really hard to guard Kyle. You know, he's, man, he's good. And he's going to be training for it. He's going to be practicing and he's going to be in shape. I mean, he's going to be a beast at the end of the summer.
What the fuck is this guy thinking? I mean, if you play make it, take it, I guess if you're playing make it, take it, and your plan is to just take him down low every single time. And I mean, I draw foul and playing foul. Like,
part of the problem with that strategy is that Kyle's tall and long. Like, Charlie's a little bit taller than Kyle, but Kyle's long and he can jump. He's athletic. Like, I think it's going to be tough. I mean, I think it's going to be tough. Yeah. I mean, I agree with you. I don't think Charlie's drawing dead. And if he like practices a bunch and he's like, I don't know, maybe he has a shot, but I don't think the odds should be even. You know.
Who's the second best out there?
Maybe Benefield, maybe Raptor.
Really?
They were on the same team too. They crushed. Oh, you know, who's good too is Huxley.
I've heard Huxley
just won a bet. Huxley just won a bet to get to 9% body fat. He fucking is so skinny. He's like 6'6", 180 pounds now. It's insane.
He's, you know, super. We need to find more people that are willing to bet us large amounts of money on physical type of things, it sounds like.
I mean, it's like I felt like such a fish when fucking Brian Rass is telling me that he like won like 8 times as much money as I did. I'm just like, what the fuck? I trained so hard for 6 months, you know? I fucking had to fight some guy in a cage.
You know how long he trained?
He trained for like 3 days.
Yeah.
Fucking guy trains for 3 days. He makes like $1 million. I was just like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
And he didn't have to like, he didn't take any risk of getting this fucking shit kicked out of him too, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, man, I feel like a fish here. Wow.
Yeah.
I also think it's helpful to be friends with certain people. Like, you know, you get into the vicinity of certain people who just want to give their money away in these bets.
I know. They're anxiously waiting to just, hey, okay, yeah, let's go ahead.
She like instigated this girl. She's like, who are you talking about? What do you mean? Yeah.
What did you see? Did you see Byron Caverman's Iron Man prop bet?
Yo, I don't know that much about Iron Man. That shit seems hard, man.
Wait, I have some graphs.
I mean, just completing the Iron Man is like,
oh,
stop taking my phone.
I keep doing that.
Super, like, just completing an Ironman is super impressive. Like, I mean, you know what I mean? Like, just completing a marathon is, like, pretty impressive. But Ironman is no joke. And then I don't know enough about the time to know if this is a real doable thing. I mean, I'm assuming they've looked into these times and they know about it, but I don't know enough to comment. But man, this is whatever. It's hardcore.
We're talking about Byron, right?
Byron Caverman, yeah.
Byron, yeah.
That's what they were talking about. It's with Dan and Bill.
Oh.
Yeah.
She's got the inside scoop on like certain text message conversations, you know.
Oh. Wonder why.
Because everybody wants to be her friend.
It's very true. What Tiago?
It's because of her spirit. You know, it's because of her spirit.
Small bet. Spirit.
It's her spirit. It's her spirit.
Bill said small bet, 50K. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's a small bet for him.
Yeah.
But it's not a small bet for like a lot of
other
people.
And he has to train for it. That sucks.
Why does it suck? I'm sure he probably already wanted to do this. My guess, people don't do stuff like this unless they already had these goals.
Yeah.
My guess is Byron, like, he's probably already run a marathon or been training for one. And, like, he probably has a swimming background. And this is all I'm just speculating, talking out of my ass. But my guess is that he wanted to do an Ironman, and this is a great motivation for him to do it.
Right.
But, I mean, if the time is tough, like, I mean, I don't know. It's maybe Bill Perkins will finally win one of these bets.
Tiago says, what do you think about the social media poker pros?
What does that mean?
Yeah,
I'm not sure what that means either, but I want to know what he means. I think I have an idea what he means.
Tell me what you think and then give him some time to answer what he means.
I think what he means by the social media poker pros is all the people that are super active. Like, you know, like the guys who are very active on Twitter, basically, who are poker players.
Well, I'm being given instructions. Hold on. Is this better?
I felt like I was like sitting on top of you.
Is this better?
Yeah.
What's happening here? Wait a second.
You wanted to change our positioning.
We're gonna be going to porn. Wait, oh, never mind. We're good. Okay, I wasn't sure where we were going. I didn't know where we were going with this one. Now I didn't know.
Have some respect, homeboy.
I mean, the webcam was up high.
Poppy, tread lightly. Tread lightly, Poppy.
I'm not sure what's happening over there. Oh, Tiago, clear. I wasn't sure. The camera was high there. I don't know what. Guys, I'm not a mind reader. I don't know what's happening.
I'm not a mind reader.
Yeah, that's TOS. Exactly. I'm worried about TOS too. I don't want my channel shut down. Come on. Tiago, please clarify your comment here, Poppy. Busquet, do you have stream or training? Man, I'm right as fuck. Busquet, do you have stream or training video somewhere? You are becoming my favorite commentator.
I don't have any stream or training videos. I don't know. Some people have asked me to do that. I don't know. I'm kind of thinking about it, but not really. My boy wants to put together like a site. And he's like the best hyper player. Mm-hmm. Heads up hyper player. And he really knows theory like really, really well. And he wants me to help him, but I'm not sure if we're going to do that or if I'm going to do that.
Strategy. Giving away it all.
I mean, you know, you might as well give it away like right before you just like stop playing.
That's true. That's true. Red Fate. Everyone's got a site these days, Lee Jam says. That's true.
Everyone has a site. I mean, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think it's gonna be tough to rival Upswing. Like those guys are real good, and they're obviously putting the time and effort in.
Kaka Man says, Kaka Man here, Papito. Ask Olivier about the message he accidentally sent me through Twitter chat.
No, We already talked about that. I knew, honestly, I was so sure he was going to be in the chat and say that.
So good.
All right, so basically, the story is real simple. So there's like a high stakes reg, good player, like seems like a decent guy, who like sometimes likes to fuck around with Sam, or used to like to fuck around with Sam. And some of the things he would say were like, kind of trolly, some were kind of like fun, and some were kind of like mean-spirited.
Most were mean-spirited.
All right, so most were mean-spirited. And so recently he sent her something, and it was not particularly nice, and it said something like about me too. And Sam was not particularly happy about that message. So like, I just like wanted to let the guy know that like, this was like not cool anymore. And so I sent him a message. I was mostly polite. I mean, I was polite in it or whatever, but I just like, I told him that I asked him to stop pretty much. But when Sam was showing me like the conversation, she showed me a screenshot and include this guy's Kakaman's like response like in on Twitter. So I stupidly thought that the person in question was behind his Twitter account. So I sent the message to him. And he was like, and he was just like, what the fuck, you know? And I was just like, right when he goes, what the fuck, I was like, oh shit, this might not be the right person. So I instantly text Sam, and I'm like, yo, is that his account? And she's like, no. And I was like, oh fuck. So then I had to, you know, apologize to the guy, and I was like, sorry, you are not the correct recipient of this message. And he was like, you know, he was like interested. He was like, you know, what's going on? Like, what's happening? And
so he's the one that responded to you saying, like, you would kick anyone's ass or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, he's the same one that was like, don't fuck with Sam. Like, you know, like, Olivier's got her back or whatever.
That was hilarious.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. That was the basis of that tweet. But it was like a very just kind of funny situation. The kid was like, I think the kid's name is Jacob. He's like really like good natured about it. He was cool. But yeah, so I made a mistake. I make mistakes a lot. That's what happened.
So funny.
Shout out to my buddy Jacob. Jacob sends me the best Snapchats ever. Usually involve like.
Oh, so you know him.
What?
Does it involve what?
He sent. Okay, so Kakaman's our resident Backpage expert. What I mean by that is he's the guy we talk to when we want to know about getting women off Backpage to have sex with. So he's big in the San Antonio area. He's actually known there in San Antonio for being one of the leading authorities in Backpage. So yeah, he's big in the Twitch stream.
Writes like reviews and stuff?
Yeah. So he'll have sex with girls on Backpage, and then he'll blog about it and write about it and stuff like that. He puts it on Snapchat and stuff like that, yeah.
They're prostitutes?
Yes.
Just to be clear.
Yes.
I'm familiar with Backpage without being that familiar with it.
No, yeah. I mean, of course not. Of course you don't know what it is. Of course not. I don't know what it is. I didn't know anything about it, Olivia, until I found out my buddy Jacob about what was happening. But yeah, that's right. What the comment is.
I'm sure Jacob introduced you to Backpage.
He did. I didn't know what he's talking. I'm like, Backpage?
Well, of course not. Why would you know?
Look at him.
Yeah. Pick up the pillow and look at it for a second. Yeah. That's everyone. This pillow. The pillow could be Backpage. I don't know what it is. It could be this. What do I know? Yeah, you know I have to get you back after the last podcast.
All right. I'll be honest. I know what Backpage is. Okay.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
He always does that. I love it.
Yeah, you're good.
I may have been there once. I may have been there once in my life.
All right. So he like writes reviews. That's his shtick. He does that thing. Okay.
Yeah.
I guess. All right. I mean, I'm sure it's a valued service from other people. I'm sure, other people appreciate it. Okay.
Wait, what?
I think that's the first time I've ever gotten that look from her. I don't know. I'm going to try not to say anything again that gives me that look.
Sam looks like she's from Backpage.
Watch it, homeboy.
I've never looked at the...
At the chat?
I haven't looked yet at the chat. Oh, this is hilarious. Sick soul read. Ha ha ha. Best pod ever. Yeah, cool. I like this chat. I'm going to keep
Sick
reading.
Sick soul read. Ha ha ha. Yeah.
Bang bang. I like this chat. I like the fucking I like the chat.
Sure. Chat. Tiago says sorry. Or hold on, let me go back up. He said
social media, yeah.
He said social media poker pros are the people who doesn't beat the games but act like they do on social media. Like Pisenio, he is down since 2013. Quote, I don't beat the games anymore. Time to do some coaching or bring new players to my sponsor.
Okay, I don't really know about anything about this group of people. I don't actually follow like that many poker people. I only use Twitter for social media and a little bit of Facebook because my fight team uses Facebook. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Like, I'm not, whatever, man. Fucking poker's hard to beat, and if you like, you know, if you're still in the poker world and you're having a tough time beating the games, like, you got to do what you can to survive, man. It's a hustle. And like, try to figure out a fucking exit strategy, you know.
I'm with you. But Camino says, Poppy, what do you think of Dean Eggs firing back shots at Sean? I have not seen those yet. I don't know.
Who's Sean?
Sean Deeb, I'm assuming.
Firing shots at Sean? Why? What's that about?
I don't know. I have not seen it yet.
Olivier only uses Twitter to take shots at the Empire. Come on, guy. I took one shot at the Empire. And that was, you know, that was after like fucking getting bazooka'd for like
two.
Months.
I
Like actual shots. Actual shots. I have. First of all, the Empire includes some like really dope people. Jason Les is the man, you know. Like
yeah.
Donger Kim. Yeah, you call him another name, but Donger is like, you know, a lot of these people are cool. Even I like Doug too, man. I don't even have a problem with Jason or Ryan. They're just whatever. They're like bullies. I'm not really cool with that. But the Empire is like yeah. whatever. I have no issues with the Empire. I also thought that tweet was pretty funny.
Is the Empire a name that's like been around for a while?
Aren't they the evil Empire?
Yeah. What is that? What is the deal with that? They name themselves that?
Yeah, I don't think.
I think they named themselves that. Yeah.
I think that was their like, hey, we're all dicks. Like, what's up?
Oh, okay. Well,
you mentioned a name, Donger Kim.
Yeah.
I like him. He's cool.
Yeah.
What does he play?
What does he play?
He plays like heads up.
I think he plays heads up.
Yeah, heads up, sit and goes.
No,
sit. He's like, oh no, just heads up.
Cash. Yeah, heads up, cash.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, didn't he have that bet against that dude that moved to Hypers? That what is his name? That guy that was like
from the UB?
Yeah.
Oh, you talking about Big Dick Donger Kim?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know you're talking about.
Oh, come on with this. What is that shtick every time this guy's name comes up, you pretend you don't know who he is? You just did that whole thing like what does he play on purpose to me to try to explain it so you could go have the aha moment and replace his name? That whole shtick was for that.
Grab the pillow.
I forgot. I'm sorry. I forgot.
Oh, yeah. It's the funniest part about that is that you say that and then you repeat his full name. It's not like you have an alternate name. It's the same name. You just have something that comes before it. There's actually no reason you wouldn't know who Donger Kim was when you say blah blah Donger Kim.
Yeah, you know. I'm sure.
I can't help it.
You know?
I don't know. Back page. The pillow could just be back page. What do I know?
God save the queen. Shout out to the fucking queen, man.
That's McLean and Tad. That's their pillow. God save the queen.
Shout out to the pillow.
Shout out to the pillow.
It's like his back page experience forgotten. That's true. Uh-huh. Poppy getting pwned. It's almost like I set myself up for these things, isn't it, guys? Come on. Jesus Christ. Come on. That might be it. We have anything else we want to say? Sam, you got anything you want to talk to the people? Sam, you got a reality show coming up. Oh, my God. You're going to be fucking – yeah. You got the reality show. Talk about that a little bit for everyone.
Do you think, girl?
What do you want to know?
She throws it right back at you. It's like, fuck you. You ask me questions.
Are you recording anything in Vegas with the girls?
I think we are, yeah. I think we have like a week, maybe. I think – I don't know, actually.
Wait, who's on the show?
I don't know. It's really unorganized.
Bang, bang.
I don't know what's going to happen with it. We'll see. Probably nothing. Fingers crossed.
Wait a sec. The show might not be... Might not... No?
I don't know. It just seems... I don't know. We'll find out. It seems pretty pretty unorganized
to
me.
Let's move on.
I mean, this is not anything that I haven't told them. Did he freeze like that, or is he okay?
Yeah, where'd you go?
I thought you were actually doing just holding your hand there like that.
Oh no, no. People want to know about Tonka. So we recently had a podcast, Sam, with a young man named Tonka. Tonka P streams on Twitch. Parker,
yeah,
tell
her. Why is that ringing a bell? Someone said, why did you break up with Tonka? And I can't remember who Tonka.
Okay, so during the last podcast, there was some speculation that you and Tonka may be a couple.
Oh, who's Tonka? And
who the fuck is Tonka?
Who's Tonka? Wait, no, tell, like, I feel bad asking. I actually wanted to ask, but I didn't.
Tonka, show yourself.
Sam, I have to tell you that the speculation may have been instigated by me because I may have.
Okay, now everything makes way more sense.
Oh yeah, you might have been the source of that. Okay.
So recently they were talking about who's Sam dating? I'm like, oh, she's dating Tonka. I heard you guys were dating each other, and he's like, yep, we're dating. Yeah.
Okay, of course he did that.
Yeah, but. You know, do you know anything about Tonka? Have you seen Tonka before?
Tonka playing any World Series events? He's going to be at the Rio anytime soon?
He might be. Let me send you the video first, and then you guys can understand it a little bit better.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I just thought it was another one of those things where I was dating someone, and people want to know what happened to that. And I'm like, who's Tonga?
She met Tonga on Backpage.
It was similar to when I said True Teller was Robert Williamson III. And people sometimes a little bit believe that, so.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's an interesting, yeah, True Teller is Robert
Williamson. Yeah, True Teller is Robert Williamson III, Mr. Omaha himself.
Danny was telling me that True Teller is just like on a different level from everyone else.
True Teller is?
Yeah, like in the 300K, that like basically nobody was really playing like him. Like he was just like putting people in super tough spots, like overbetting turns and rivers, that he was just like, he's like essentially taking like his style, which is not that uncommon in the like high stakes, like 25-50 games on stars or whatever, but nobody in the tournament plays or can beat those games pretty much. So it was just like, nobody's really playing like this guy. He's just like super, like, you know, maniac, like just doing crazy shit. I thought that was interesting, you know? And that's why I thought it was like, it's a shame we didn't get to see him play more, because a lot of people are approaching this, you know, playing these tournaments. She's like straight grilling me. She's like, huh? What did you say? What did you say? A lot of people are, you know, people play like pretty similarly to each other, you know? So if somebody's really good and doing something very different, that would have been really interesting to watch.
But, yeah.
But he didn't get a lot of play.
We got to get him on the podcast, man. That should be one of our goals this summer. Get him on the podcast.
How's his English?
I don't know. Actually, that's a good question. That's the most of the Russians that I've talked to. They don't think their English is good enough to come on the pod. So.
Yeah.
OTB Red Baron. I think when I talk, maybe not OTB. I think For Haley is the one that told me that.
OTB is Russian.
OTB is. Maybe not. No, I don't think he's Russian. Actually, never mind. No, he's not Russian. For Haley's Russian.
That guy sits in the 5K. It's so annoying.
Which guy? OTB Red Baron?
Yeah.
Have you played him at all?
Like 6 times. I played it like under 10 times.
Was he any good?
Yeah, obviously.
I'm assuming yes.
Yeah. Obviously he's good. I mean, I haven't played him enough to like really get a sense, but it's not someone I'm interested in finding out like how good he is.
OTB is Belgian. He's right. A Belgian. Okay, I didn't know he's Belgian.
Yeah.
Saul Schiller on Twitter. Oh, okay. Guys, any last questions? That it? Sam, anything else we want to add, guys, out there?
I like your tank top. I've been wanting to tell you that for, I don't know, an hour and a half.
Thank you. I got it because it matches my hair.
Oh, nice. Where's it from?
It's from, I don't remember, a store in the mall in San Diego. I can't remember what it's called, though.
How much did it cost?
$12.
Sick.
Yeah, those are the best. Because you can't wear that all the time anyway. You know?
You what?
You can't wear that. You're like, what? I've been wearing it for a week now. You can't wear that tank top all the time, you know, because it's unique. So people will notice.
Right.
So it's better that it's cheaper because then you can buy more of them.
GTO fashion strategy right there, mommy.
Yeah, you can have more types of stuff.
Oh, great question, LeBax. Maybe this might be our last one. Poppy, what does Olivia think about PLP's game?
Who, Pratt?
PLP.
Don't do this shit again.
Pussy loving Pratouche. Yeah, PLP. Right.
What do I think about his game?
Yeah,
I don't,
let's talk about Pratouche.
I don't know. She turns right on. I don't know enough about his game. I mean, I think Pratt's good. Like, you know, I think he was playing, I think he was like working with Doug a bit. I think he was always good and I'm sure he's got better. I haven't played too much with him. In my personal interactions with him, seems like real cool, real sweet guy, smart, like thoughtful. I remember I read something that he wrote about, I think it was like a blog, just like getting into some stuff that he was dealing with. And I thought it was like really honest and like well thought through and like well written.
Yeah,
I mean, I'm a big fan of PLP. I mean, I can say it if it's the abbreviated form. I like Pratt. I'm a fan of Pratt.
Yep. BDDK is the other abbreviated form of the other name as well, too, right?
Oh,
I didn't know that, but it's like it seems more awkward to say the four letters like that.
We need to get you a nickname, Olivier.
Yeah, we do.
Can it be like one that I could say to my mom?
Maybe. Thanks. It can have an acronym which you can make up a new name for just your mother. Yeah.
That's not how that works. My mom's not an idiot. My mom will figure out that that's not the
actual PLP, poker loving Pratouche.
Yeah, my mom my mom actually watches interviews and stuff. Like, she'll figure it out. She has a Google alert on her phone where, like, my name pops up on Google. She'll figure it out. She's a smart lady.
All right, Olivier, what's a good nickname? What? Real quick.
No. Don't put time pressure on yourself. Let it come naturally.
Yeah, I gotta let it come naturally to me. My first thing that came to mind was hammer swinging Busquet, but you know.
I'm good without that one.
He's like, nope.
Double entendre for that one.
don't make it about my last name.
Backpage Busquet.
Great, perfect. That was perfect.
Stud liver.
Oh my God. What did she like that one?
Stud liver.
Limp Busquet. Thanks. I'm glad you introduced this idea to the chat. Great.
Booty banging Busquet. This guy being mean.
Oh, Olivier annoying cunt Busquet.
Oh my God. I can't take this podcast anymore. Joey Blunt. I'm trying to think about it. It really
funny. Wait, you timed someone out? What did they say? Shit, I didn't see what they said.
That was the one comment about the annoying cut one.
Oh, you timed that guy out?
I gotta put these guys in check, man. Kim Jong Joey's on the prowl here.
Mama.
Come on.
His daughter is kind of cute.
Limp,
amazing. Oh my God, this chat is on fire.
Limp Busquet, double entendre as well, potentially.
Yeah, but come on, his daughter is kind of cute.
His name's Real Fanopathy.
Oh my God.
Booty Biscuit.
Yeah, love the chat.
Can I call you Booty Biscuit?
Booty Biscuit Busquet. Oh my God. Oh my God. Big Biscuit Busquet. BBB.
Why are you doing this?
Yeah, this is great. This is awesome.
Oh my God, dude.
It's dark.
I'm sorry. Oh my God. All right, guys. What else you want to say?
Are you staying with the Tatiana that was doing the, like...
Sean Deeb doesn't like me? Oh, that's not nice.
What do you say?
I don't know. I don't understand why Sean Deeb thinks he's one of the biggest douches in poker scene school. I like Sean Deeb. Oh, he doesn't like
me? I
do
too.
That's a shame.
I think he said something like that in the pod, yeah.
Oh, he did?
Maybe, yeah.
Oh, well.
Dan tried to fight him.
Dan Coleman?
Yeah.
What? You froze for a second. What did you say? Dan Coleman tried to fight Sean Deeb?
He said, Sean Deeb said that Dan Coleman tried to start a fight with him at a live event, I believe in Monaco or Monte Carlo or something like that, yeah. Back in the day.
I'm confused what that has to do with me.
Am I
What?
That's what I remember from that story. I don't remember why he doesn't like you.
I mean, there's probably a long list of reasons. But I like him. I just for the record, I like him.
Mm. Yeah, I like Sean.
But Sean is friends with Matt Glantz, isn't he?
Yeah.
Come on.
Maybe that stems from that.
I like Matt too. He's not terrible.
Yeah, let's move on.
Let's wrap this one up.
What did you just do just now?
Yeah, what did you just do?
What was that
move? I had to look at something on my phone. I'm doing something tonight. I wanted to see what time we were leaving.
What are you doing?
What are you doing?
I'm meeting up with one of the all-time podcast favorite guests tonight with his girlfriend.
Hold on. Well, all-time favorite podcast guest with his girlfriend. not Ben Tollering.
Ben Tollering, exactly.
All right.
Yeah.
Wow, that was really great. Who's that?
She goes, "Who's that?" I love, Sam doesn't know a lot of people.
You know, babe?
She's constantly, people call up in poker, and she's just like, "Who's that? I don't know who that is." And I'm like, "Really? This person's a legend." She's like, "Not to me."
I never say that.
You're always like, "I'm probably better than that."
No, I don't.
Sam thinks she's better than pretty much everyone.
I definitely have never said that before.
She's probably like, "He's such shit. His game is weak."
Maybe that.
His game is weak. Sam thinks a lot of people's games are weak.
Is that true?
Sam's not like that.
I hope you don't say that about... You think you're better at PLO than Ben, Sam?
I've literally never thought I was good at PLO.
No, the real question you should have asked is, how long have you thought you were better at PLO?
I didn't even know you played PLO until you just said that. And like, now it's like obvious.
That's, yeah. Just give her like a week to study.
Wow, this is...
I remember last year you were taking the open face Chinese games by storm, Sam, after only a couple weeks of learning that, right?
Yeah.
She crushes that.
That true? I don't know what to think anymore.
I mean, as far as I know.
I mean, it's to the point now where everyone's like, I mean, there are still some fish out there, but most of the people that you play are like, I don't know.
Reasonable?
Yeah, on the same level. It doesn't, there's like a point where you kind of plateau, I think. And then it's just variance.
You play that game, Joey?
Oh, I've never really played it, no.
Me and you both.
Yeah, I'm not really interested in playing that game. I'd rather learn other games and that don't involve gambling than learn any more about that game,
Balderdash.
I think.
Like Balderdash.
Like Balderdash, exactly. Guys, I feel like there's a drinking podcast in our future in Vegas this year.
Let's do it. I don't really drink, but I'll do it for you.
Whoa, special.
I'll probably get drunk real fast.
Yeah, he's
lightweight. I'd probably be like...
You think so? You think you're getting drunk that fast?
Yeah, I mean, I don't drink ever.
100%.
Oh. Wow, okay. Well, that one should be good. I'm sure people will be very excited for that one.
You good?
Yeah,
you good with that? Okay. Yeah, so whatever. I'll do it.
I'm teaching him how to shuffle.
I don't dare. No way.
Well, I mean, I'm learning too, but we're both learning.
Oh, is Olivia, who's a better dancer, you or Sam?
I already pointed at you.
Oh.
She's waiting. She's looking at me.
Like,
she's good.
No, he's really good at dancing.
Can we see him?
Show us a move.
No, that's not happening. Come on, go on, please. That's definitely not happening.
All right.
I'm saying this right now. It's not happening. First of all, I saw the pod. Don't even give me shit because I saw your pod when he asked you to dance, and that was weak sauce. You fucking punted on that shit hard. So don't try and go there.
Okay, but I did do a handstand upside down.
You did a handstand upside down. You can do a handstand in your sleep.
Yeah, but I did it on the couch. That's like... Come on, that was like next level a little bit. I could have gone out the window.
It's closed. I mean, it's clear, but there's a glass there.
All right, guys.
That's it? Wait, are there any good comments? What's up?
I'm sure there's a lot of comments.
That's
the best.
Don't laugh.
I think we all saw that at the same time.
Olivia and dancing. What about dancing with the poker stars?
Well, I don't even know what that means.
That'd be so fun.
Like a show with just poker people?
A show with poker people where poker players dance, yeah.
I mean, that would be a train wreck, I think.
Yeah. And
did you see the Dancing with the Stars with the UFC fighter girl? She was dope.
She was really good.
She was really good.
Who? Which one?
I forget her name. Sorry.
Yeah, the blonde girl.
I should not have told the story about knowing your name.
I do that all the time. Just talk. I talk about something, I only know like 50% of what I'm talking about.
That's okay.
1 to 10.
Beautiful parenting. Love this, Dad.
Wait, I didn't see that one. Where is that one?
Michael.
Michael. Who's better at cooking? I don't know. I don't cook. Sam cooks a little bit.
Yeah, better at cooking.
Okay.
Yes,
like that one.
She's better at life skills.
Aww.
Guys, in 3 months, this is either going to be the cutest thing ever or something that they both won't want to watch back. We'll see. We'll see 3 to 10 to 25 months.
I happy. You just gave me so much credit.
What do you mean? Oh, I know.
Jesus.
People have to watch all this back.
We're going 20 days at a time. We're going 20 days at a time.
10 days.
Was it 10?
10 more. Yeah.
We were in Jamaica. We were in Jamaica, and I had them prepare this like really like romantic like dinner by the beach, right? And it was like just the two of us, like candlelit, like by the water, or whatever. And it was like it was literally like the 10th day that we had hung out together. Like we'd only been together for 10 days. And like, you know, they like pour us some champagne and we're like going to give a toast. And I like give some, like, I like say something, I forget what I said, but I said something and it was like, you know, sentimental and nice or whatever. It was like, cool. And I forget how it came up, but she wanted to give a toast too. So she gave a toast and she was like, I forget exactly what she said, but she was like, to the past 10 days. And she was like, and to 10 more. She toasted like into 10 more days. And I was like, what the fuck? I was like, our trip in Jamaica is planned to be more than 10 more days. Like, what's going to happen in 10 days? So that's been like a running joke between us. She literally, like, it was like this like romantic, like serious moment. And she was like, to 10 more days. And I didn't even say shit. I was just like, yeah, 10 more days. And we toasted and we drank. We had like a whole conversation. We waited like 3 hours before I was like, what the fuck was that toast about? And then we had a good laugh. She laughed for like an hour straight about that.
To 10 more.
She was like, 10 more. We've been toasting to 10 more days ever since then.
Oh my fucking God.
What are you doing?
Bambi banging Busquet.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, that's perfect. My mom will never fucking figure that code out.
Tiago says, Busquet doesn't drink. I love drinking and watching the podcast. Joe is my virtual drinking partner, but he doesn't know it yet.
But not, you're not a partner if you're not also drinking.
Good point. But right. I'm in.
I don't want to bring that guy's brain.
I'm the drinking partner for you, buddy. Go rip or been taking it easy after the fight. Will he take off his shirt?
No, the steroids wore off, so like I'm pretty skinny now.
You probably don't want to show everyone that then.
No, I mean I lost like a little bit of weight. Like I was on creatine, and so like some of the water weight went away, and I was like, in Jamaica, I didn't really do much. We didn't eat that much. So I lost a little bit of weight. But I still, you know.
We ate so bad.
Yeah. But no, I mean, I'm still, whatever. It's not going to take long to get it back.
Okay.
Okay. Is that good? You good with that?
I'm good with that.
I'm good with that.
I'm good with that.
I bet 1 million I'd beat you in an MMA fight.
This relationship is higher variance than PLO, Poppy.
Okay.
Can all of you take your shirts off?
We all take our shirts off.
We all take our shirts
off. That is a great idea. Let's just do that.
I'll happily take off my shirt.
We know that you will. Why don't you just take your shirt off?
Are you sunburned?
I don't know. I'm waiting to find out. I'm sunburned here because I was playing basketball with my tank top on.
Oh, you were playing with the tank top? Let me see the tan lines.
Yes, come on. Come on.
Let's see if we have any. Nope.
How'd you do that?
You're getting pretty jacked.
Yeah, huh? I was.
You're getting pretty jacked.
Yeah.
Kid, after the pod, I was like, man, I got to get better shape, dude.
I think you're doing it. It's like the real deal.
I used to be very, very fit back in the day, like when I only focused on working out, but then I got into poker, so I stopped working out as much.
When you wore the collared shirts back in those days, you were then.
Back when I wore Phil Hellmuth sized t-shirts, the AKA medium sized shirts. Yeah.
Medium.
Why does he do that? I don't, that part I don't really get actually.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
What?
Like he consistently wears shirts that are too small for him. Oh. I don't know why he does that.
I used to wear it because I always thought I was showing off my muscles and the chicks liked it back in the day when I was 19, 20, 21.
I don't think it's the same situation, though.
Yeah. So.
Maybe.
No, so when you were 21, you were like jacked up? You were all cut up?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I was pretty big. Yeah.
Poppy's got pics in the archives.
What? Oh, yeah. Back in the day. Yeah. Those with the hairs all spiky. Yeah. I was. Yeah.
Guy. That's awesome. Were you playing sports too?
He
popped
his collar and everything.
Okay, I did do that too. That was cool, though.
Yeah, it was cool then.
I mean, you seem cool.
Yeah, okay. Bang, bang. No, I did I play sports? No, I just worked out.
Were you just doing, like, the upper body prison look or what?
Oh, yeah, for sure, 100% don't. There was no lower body activity happening at all, no.
I mean, once the lower body becomes relevant, it's kind of like game over anyway. That's how you need it? Like, for you're working out to be jacked for girls?
I think at the time, yeah. Because I was used to be, yeah, pretty much I just wanted to, yeah, that's kind of why I started working out, to get the chicks, yeah, the chick. Of course.
Where were you living when you were 21?
Indiana, or Illinois, Chicago, or suburbs of Chicago, south side of Chicago.
South side?
Not there. A little more south than the south side.
The suburbs.
It was like toward the horseshoe, like Indiana direction?
Yeah, kind of towards there, yeah. Yeah.
Are you going to EDC?
It's on day twos on the 3K PLO day, so I might go day one and then maybe, yeah, I think I'm going to go day one for sure.
Sweet.
Why, are you guys going?
I mean, I want to go.
Which means she's going. Yeah, for sure. Now the question is whether I'm going to go too.
Yeah.
I've never gone. I don't know. She's going to have to convince me to go.
I mean, it's a lot of fun, dude. You're a lot of fun.
I got to wait till it gets a little closer so I can start convincing.
Yeah, she hasn't even really started working.
I got to wait till, because like then there's too much build up, you know? It has to be like right before. Then I have to tell him like how much fun it's going to be.
It'll definitely 100% be a lot of fun for sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think I'm gonna go. I'm gonna go Friday. And yeah. Who am I gonna bring? I think I'm decided. I'm not doing a big group this year because last year I did a big group and I don't want to do a big group again. I just want to do.
Well, you went last year.
I've been a couple times. Yeah, last year I went with Lafort and the German players, and that was a pretty
good. German players. There's like that doesn't seem that specific.
Greenwoods and Justin.
Greenwoods who are not German?
Giuseppe?
No, Max and Sam.
So not German?
Not German. And then Scott Siever, the bottom
also
of.
Not German.
Jeff Rossiter was in that group, I believe.
Yep, also not German.
No German.
All single German yet, by the way.
There's no fucking Germans in the group. What are you talking about?
You just named German. Four people who weren't German.
I never said there were Germans.
Yeah, you said I went with the Germans.
What?
I said I went with the tournament players.
Oh.
Okay. I mean, I really wish we could rewind that.
If I said I went, yeah, I might have, man. I'm losing my fucking mind. I literally might have said that. I don't know, but.
Okay. Oh, so you went with that crew. Oh, that's cool. Okay, cool.
Yeah, I went that group, but.
That crew is a cool group?
They're fun. I don't really hang out with them too much there. I hung out with a friend of mine.
How was that the crew you went with?
Lafort.
That's, oh yeah, right. Okay, that's the connection.
Yeah, he lives in Toronto with some of those guys. Oh, Dan was there too, Dan Smith. And
oh, did he write a blog about his experience?
That was Burning Man.
Right. EDC is nothing like Burning Man, right?
Right, nothing, yeah, no.
Do you have interest in going to Burning Man?
No.
That's why this is my girl right here. Love it.
Nothing against it, but I just...
No, I'm not down. I'm not really into it.
No.
I felt like Sam was someone that could kind of go either way. She was going to have an opinion for sure, but I wasn't sure which one it was going to be. That was the one I was looking for.
Sam seems very Burning Man to me. I could see Sam going to Burning Man.
I just feel like it's so... I actually don't want to share how I feel about it because I don't want to offend anyone. People are going to think I'm talking about them specifically, you know? And I'm not.
It's not a thing. It's not a thing.
Yeah.
Leave it at that.
I don't think that I would enjoy it.
Yo, let
me see. I think there are aspects that I can really, really enjoy. And like the art and everything. Like,
what just happened?
Coffee?
Mike, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. I gotta change the title of this video. It was just supposed to be us discussing the Super High Roller, and then it turned into a fun podcast where I've laughed more than I've ever laughed in a podcast before.
Yo, I want to see how jacked you are.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, let's do it.
What do you want me to do?
I want you to take the thing that you're wearing off so I can see how jacked
you are. I'm not taking off my shirt on the podcast, you fuckers.
Why not?
No.
Why are you pretending like you're some shy dude? Just fucking take it off.
What are you talking about?
Oh, my
Didn't
God.
Didn't you strip before? Oh,
yeah, you've done, like, your dances and your fucking handstands and shit. Just, like, show everybody how jacked you are. You know you want to. You just want me to convince you. Just do it.
Look at him. Convince me.
Yeah, he's like, no, please keep going. No, please keep going.
It's fine. I can't. Give me 2 weeks.
Ah, that's why. Oh, you're not happy with the product.
That's
what it is.
No, I've only been working hard at it now for a couple since like a month and a half now, a month.
Okay, well, just so we're clear, I understand why you don't want to show it, because you're not there. You're not at that point. Okay. I respect that, but
I know how it feels to feel like you're at that point, and I don't feel like I'm at that point yet. No.
Yo, have you seen Danny? Danny's fucking jacked.
Dude, what the fuck, man? This doesn't even make sense. Yeah, I didn't even realize that, and then I saw something on Snap, and I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah. He hasn't really done that much this year. You know what I mean? Like, hasn't really played that much poker. But he's like got a trainer. Has been training like 5 or 6 days a week, and like he started eating like well. And you know, contrary to popular belief, you know, if you train for a while and you eat well, like you can really change the way your body looks.
Yeah, he said he was doing no lower body, but he's thinking about getting into some lower body.
He said he was doing no lower body? What an idiot! Really?
Yeah.
He has a trainer too. I'm surprised his trainer
might be. He might be starting to do some lower body stuff.
Who are we talking about? Who's calling me?
Your crush. Oh. Dan Coleman.
Oh.
She's like, oh, my crush. That doesn't narrow it down. I don't know.
Awkward.
Who's among us?
Awkward.
It's not awkward. No, this is how we are. We're good. Don't worry.
Wait, is that really your crush, Sam? Dan Coleman?
I'm sorry, what?
You know Olivia and him are pretty good friends, right?
Yeah, we're like brothers. And this was like one of the first conversations Sam and I ever had. And she was like kind of asking me about Danny. And I was like, fuck
this
me.
This was not the first conversation we ever had.
Not the first one, but like it was pretty early on in the conversation. And I was like, Sam, I think you're cool. She's like, really? Thanks. What's up with Dan?
Bang, bang.
I was like, motherfucker. This kid wins all the money. He's fucking 10 years younger than me. Fuck me, man.
Now Dan is in love with a wonderful Brazilian woman.
Mm-hmm. This we know. Yes, we're very happy for Danny. So Sam, what do you do with poker players going to Brazil and coming back hitch?
Dude, I have no fucking idea, but it makes me want to go to Brazil. Like,
yeah.
Let's go. Let's go. That's what we should do.
We were going to go. We were about to go.
We'll take Poppy. We'll find him.
Find him a lady friend.
It'll be
actually. You know what I've heard? I've heard that you don't need to try. Like somebody told me like a pickup line in Rio de Janeiro is just like bumping into someone and just saying "excuse me" in English. Like once they realize that you're like American, they're like all about it.
The problem is that I'm gonna. There's a 100% chance I might want to bring someone back to the country. It seems like a problem.
Why is that a problem?
It seems like a good problem to have for you.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to bring them back, then that means things are good. If you don't want to, then don't bring them back.
That's a fair point. It's a fair point, guys. I mean, listen, I'm not against the idea. In fact, I like the idea.
It seems like you love the idea, and you can't wait, actually.
I do love the idea.
We were going to go. I actually got my visa, and like it was easier for me because I was in New York, so I was like, I could just go to the embassy. But Sam couldn't get it in time.
Yeah, the one here is closed just like indefinitely. So I have to go to LA to get it.
Instead of Jamaica, we were going to go to Rio. We were going to go to Rio with Danny, but then Danny like wasn't feeling good. I don't know. I think he thought something was a serious problem, but I don't think it is.
He's a hangnail.
Yeah, I think he had like a
real serious.
He had like a pulled muscle or something. I don't know. he's okay.
That's great. That's awesome.
But I think that's what it was. I'm not kidding. So he didn't go either, but like Jeff was there. I think Brian Rass was there. Jeff Gross was there with his girl.
Yeah, I think Jeff and Brian were up down there playing Scoop, I believe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we were going to join them, but Jamaica worked out pretty well. No.
What was that comment I read? The green card grind. I forgot a lot of women in Brazil are on the green card grind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have like a spot that you like to go to like chill? Like a Caribbean spot, a Mexico spot, like a spot that is like your spot?
I usually go San Diego.
Okay.
That's my place. Caribbean. I've never really been to the Caribbean. Have I? I've been to Bahamas PCA, but I've never been to the Caribbean though.
I saw you at the Bahamas.
You saw me?
Yeah, I sat right next to you actually at a bar for like 5 minutes.
Which bar?
Got him.
Which bar? The bar, it was like, it's part of a restaurant. It's like in the casino. It was like towards the end of the trip.
Was I drunk?
You were drinking. You were with a lady.
I was with my girlfriend at the time.
Yeah, fair enough.
Really? I don't know. What the, I must have been. I was fucked up at that point.
I was really paying attention to me, but I noticed you.
Oh.
Just saying. That's what happened.
Dang, I was Japan.
This is new?
My shoes?
Hold on, yeah. Hold on. You got to see this.
Yeah, my shoes. They're dope, right?
Yeah. How do I take... Whoa, those are awesome.
You want me to take them off?
Yeah, you got to see this shoe.
These are the Kyrie Irvings. Just got them in Nike Town. Man, how's it?
Let's see. Poppy, big time Olivier? No, I didn't. Come on. What are you talking about?
I don't know why I'm looking at your computer because that's where the chat is. Totally big time me. Totally. I went up to them and I was like, hey, I'm a big time and I really want to meet you. You just completely ignored me.
I did not feel homies anyone. Stop it in the chat. Stop it. Let's see these shoes.
Okay. She like built them up. I don't know.
With the strap though, that strap was cool. Hold on.
Those are pretty dope. I like those.
And they're honestly the best basketball shoe I've ever played in. They're light. They're dope traction. They're
the
really,
strap
really
is
good.
So cool.
Those the shoe is amazing. Like if you're looking for a new basketball, I think these are the Kyrie Irvings. They're
very similar to the newer Kevin Durant shoes with the strap in the top.
Why'd you just do that? I wore them once. They can't be that bad.
Did you smell the shoes? Oh my god, dude.
What's your view on consumerism? Jesus Christ. The view on consumerism.
Do you see that? Oh my gosh. 21 minutes into this video. What?
What are you laughing at?
Know, I'm not laughing at anything.
Are you laughing at the chat? Which chat are you laughing at?
Big time. I mean, there could be a number of things I'm laughing at in the chat. I can't say this one back. I don't get in trouble with it. I don't want anything written about me.
This guy needs to go.
Kyrie Irving shoes affiliate code.
We had a disagreement. He doesn't know about it yet.
What do you say?
21 minutes into this podcast, Binks had crawled up on a box. I was like unboxing stuff. Binks was on top of it. He tried to stand up. He tried to stand up at the microwave and just completely fell off the box. It was hilarious. I was cracking up so hard. Yeah, I don't even think you saw it. It's in the video. I'll show you. Hold on. Look at this.
All right, this is the last question. Are you guys poker's new power couple? Is that true?
Who's poker's old power couple? Tread carefully.
Fuck do I know? I don't know who it was.
Well, how can we be the new one if we don't know who the old one was?
Kevin McAfee and Liv Boree.
Man, don't do that.
Well, I could have. I don't know. I'm trying to name a couple. No. Liv and Igor. They're kind of. I mean, are they a power couple though?
What does power couple mean?
I don't even know what it means. I'm thinking about who is the old power couple. The only older couple I think about is Liv Boree and Kevin McAfee. It's the only older couple I even know exist.
Why are you saying Liv has a boyfriend that's not him?
You said older power couple, like old. I don't know who the new one is. I don't know. I haven't thought about it in a long time.
Okay. I don't know what that means. We're just who we are. Okay.
Very humble. Lauren Kling and ADZ. Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Like, really? No. There's no reason to make any sort of comparison with that. Those two people. I don't like. We're not. We're not affiliated.
Well, previous to everything happened with that. Yeah. Wait. No. Seriously. No. I'm kidding. Who was the power couple? Really? I know Liz.
Why are you? Why are you pursuing this line of conversation?
I'm thinking about the old Fedor and my ex-girlfriend. Could have been at the PCA, bang, bang. Nope, not Sam and Dan, no, not that. Lack and Tilly, maybe, no, not really. Eric Lindgren and Benjamin's ex-girlfriend, no. Maybe, yeah, I guess that could be one, sure.
Erica Schoenberg or whatever?
Yeah, Erica Lindgren, correct.
Okay.
Doc Sands and his girl, no. Or it could be, I don't know, they play poker, I'm not sure. Could be, yeah, sure. Vanessa Selps did
not. Fund One and Timex.
Jungle and his Romanian girlfriend, no. I mean, could be. Yeah, it's another one, too. I don't know, guys. That's a good question.
Joey and PLP.
Yeah, me and PLP, exactly. Anything else you want to add to the chat? I think that's all we got. Do we got anything else?
Oh, man. I was supposed to eat before this podcast. Fuck, man, I'm starving.
I had this plan.
5 o'clock? Holy shit. The fucking basketball game's going to start soon.
Yeah, I had a plan for an hour. I don't know what happened. I guess that's it.
At least you were laughing a bunch of it. That was the best part.
Yeah.
It was hilarious. Joey and no, that's not me. Natasha and Jason?
Oh, they seem cool.
Could be.
I love them.
Yeah.
Could be.
Natasha, all right, guys.
I'll see you soon.
Natasha came firing hard defending Jay. I like that.
What'd you say?
Natasha came out firing hard defending Jay.
Oh, yeah.
I know. She got in the battle. I like that a lot, too. She got in there, man. She battled it up.
Yeah, she's like, don't fuck with my man. I like that. That was cool.
I like that. Sam, would you do that same thing?
Didn't you see her? She created that gif where she was punching Doug and Ryan.
That's a good point. She did. You're right. I like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah. Honestly, like, if people don't know, like, you do not want to mess around with Sam in the social media game. She has mad talents, mad skills. Like, without trying, she will just crush whoever tries. That's not a challenge, okay? But, like, you don't want to try that.
We had a little, what'd you call it, investigation?
Yeah, that's your story. Sam's
yeah,
crazy.
We had a little bit of an investigation this week. Ended up crushing. I got a little obsessed for a few days.
Are you going to get into the story or no?
I don't know. Maybe not. I'll tell you later.
Who did you crush? Wait a second.
Let's just say somebody tried to mess with Sam in like a legit way, like a real way.
Yeah.
And that person got destroyed.
Demolished.
Oh my God. I saw another side of Samantha Abernathy that I was like legit frightened by. I was like, holy shit. Fucking Inspector Clouseau over here. She did some hardcore detective work.
Can we know the person's name? Who's the person?
No. I don't even think the name would be relevant. I it's up to Sam to say.
Tell you this. A non-poker player, I mean, maybe like hobby.
Yeah.
Attempted to make a profile on a website using my identity to sell action to random people, promising them like ROI on my tournament.
To defraud them.
Yeah. But also telling them like, sending them my links to my like hidden mob, my social media, telling them where I'm going to be this summer, promising them 50-50 deal on all my tournament action. So I'm just going to have these random people out there expecting like to have a piece of my tournament.
When Sam wins the main, like there's going to be people coming knocking on the door for some money.
But I mean, even if I just like min cash or like make a deep run or whatever. Yeah. So I was not okay with it. And made a few fake profiles of my own, like communicated with this person like nonstop for 2 days straight.
She did more than that.
I found their geolocation, like their
she
exact
fucking
pinpoint.
Pinpointed their. She sent me this thing. She was like, "I have their coordinates." I was like, "What?" I'm like, "What the fuck are you talking about?"
Yeah.
She was nonstop.
I was fully ready to fly the drone over their house, but
she's not kidding.
Yeah.
So what happened? How did it end?
She got them to admit what they did.
I got them to send me a photo holding their ID. I pressured them that hard.
She essentially like bluffed them. She was basically like, you know, like, I'm with the police right now. I'm going to file a report. I already know who you are. I just want you to come clean, basically. And that shit worked.
It took some time, but
She just owned so hard. It was like impressive and frightening at the same time. Don't fuck around.
Well, guys, we're ending at that. I gotta go. I gotta go eat. I'm ready for the drunk podcast to take place because I feel like
it's gotta be in person, obviously.
That one might set. Of course, be in person. That one might set a record for the new longest podcast, guys.
That'll be so.
Wait, what
fun.
Is your current longest podcast?
It's long. It's long.
Wait, the one with Fedor that's like 6 hours or something.
5 hours. Yes, that one's long as fuck, dude.
Yeah.
That one was a lot. That one, it didn't even seem like 5 hours either. I mean, it kind of did towards the end because for certain reasons I don't want to get into on the podcast now, but it did. So
I just don't want to try to break the record. If we break it, we break it, but we don't have to, like, you know.
Yeah, it'll be easy, I'm pretty sure. I mean, well, you're going to be drunk in, like, after, like, 20 minutes anyway, so.
I know. I'm going to take a nap during the podcast and come back.
Yeah. All right, guys, we'll be back. I'll be back tomorrow with Andrew Barber. Andrew Barber recently wrote about markup in tournaments and tournament packages, so we're going to be talking all about that stuff. And
smart guy, the guy.
What did you say?
He's a smart guy.
Yeah, I think he's a very smart guy. That'll be tomorrow, 6 p.m. Eastern time, 3 p.m. my time. And then I might be podcasting with Tatiana, a.k.a. Tatty Tat. She recently just did the Super High Roller coverage. She was the sideline reporter, I think was her official title. And yeah, so I might do that with her. I'm not sure the time or date for that. Might be this weekend. And that's all I got scheduled for sure. I have a lot of other stuff coming up in June, a lot of live podcasts in Vegas, a lot of videos, probably not. I say that, but I probably won't record them. And it's going to be a very fun month. I'm very excited to see what happens. And that's it. Guys, everyone wish luck to Olivier and Sam on another profitable 10 days together. May they run above expectation for as long as they can. I suppose we can say it like that. So guys in the chat, appreciate all the comments, appreciate all the questions. And we'll be back. We'll be back tomorrow.
Yo, who are you rooting for in the basketball?
Cavaliers. Yeah. Cavaliers. That's it. Peace out, guys. Adios.